over the course of the last few years to do all that we can to support the most vulnerable in our society.
Thanks. And that concludes portfolio questions. And we now move on to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion number 14167 in the name of Ken Macintosh on housing and wellbeing in Scotland. I'd invite all members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And when you're ready, Mr. Macintosh, I'd invite you to speak for 14 minutes or thereby, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, over the summer I was asked for help by a young family with three children aged 2 to 8. They had chosen to give up their council house as it was becoming increasingly cramped, and in the absence of any other options, reluctantly moved into a private let to find room for their growing family. No sooner had they moved into the new property when they were served with an eviction notice. Circumstances had changed and the landlord needed the house back. Now, this family was given 2 months to find a new home. They had no legal grounds on which they could challenge the landlord, and despite holding down a steady and secure job, no chance of being able to afford to buy a house anywhere nearby. When I asked the local authority, they said they only had 14 suitable properties in the area and very little chance of one of them becoming vacant in the next year, never mind in the immediate future. So here they were. School was about to start back, but the family didn't even know if their children would have a home, let alone one near their own community, relatives and friends. How familiar is that story to members across the chamber? There are more than 150,000 people waiting to find a social rented house in Scotland. The number of new homes being built has fallen to 40% since 2007. And the percentage of families owning their own home is also declining, with affordability being a huge problem for young people in particular. The net effect has been to drive people into an ever-expanding private sector with, in many areas, ever-increasing rent levels to match. Now, in some cases, private renting is exactly what is required to address local need, but for others, it is unaffordable and insecure, with rents rising at double or treble any increases in levels of income, and with no guarantees, as in this case, against being chucked out with little notice. Presiding Officer, we need to offer those in private lets some of the protection available to those in social rented accommodation. A quarter of those renting privately are families with children, and they need to know that they are safe and secure, that they can stay at the same school with the same friends and community around them. The Scottish Government have yet to spell out what will be in their private tenancies bill, but I hope they will take the 5 asks of shelters make renting right as their starting point. Stability, flexibility and security of tenure for both tenants and landlords, accompanied by predictable rents with a fair system for sorting out problems when they occur. This should not be seen as an anti-landlord measure. Landlords need to know that they can get rid of bad tenants or get their property back if they need to sell it. In fact, if the main problem we are facing is a problem of housing supply, one of the potential solutions is to attract large institutional investors into the sector to build substantial numbers of properties for private rent, much as we have seen recently with the expansion of purpose-built student accommodation to rent. And in a world where investment capital is highly mobile, I do not underestimate the difficulty in getting the legislative or regulatory balance right. Now, I'll return to the private rented sector, or the PRS, as it's commonly referred to, shortly. But before I do, I believe it is important that we recognise that neither the difficulties my constituents face nor the sheer scale of the housing challenge across Scotland will be resolved through regulating private tenancies. We are quite simply facing a housing crisis in Scotland, and one that will only be resolved by building more homes, tens of thousands more homes. These are not my observations, but the conclusions of the Independent Commission on Housing and Wellbeing. It is very easy for our debates on housing to get into a battle of numbers, and I notice the Government's amendment proudly highlights the commitment to 30,000 new affordable homes, which it clearly expects to deliver on by next year. The difficulty is that that figure does not reflect housing need in Scotland, a point that has been made yet again in the press today by the SFHA, Shelter and Homes for Scotland. So rather than degenerate into an overly partisan exchange comparing the record of different administrations, one of the purposes of the motion that we have put down today is to see if we can find agreement around the work and the findings of the Independent Commission on Housing and Wellbeing. And first of all, can I say how much I welcome the report and the contribution I hope it makes to developing housing policy in Scotland. Set up in 2013 by Shelter Scotland and chaired by the former Auditor General Robert Black, the principal goal of the Commission has been to look at the ways in which housing can and does impact on the wider well-being of the people of Scotland. This non-partisan, unbiased, independent Commission has examined the impact of poor housing on people's health, education, employability and life chances. It highlights the links between housing and the problems of poverty and inequality. And it points to the wider gains in terms of educational attainment, care for older people and improved mental health secured by a decent home. Following a lengthy consultation with the public, with housing experts and drawing on the expertise of organisations such as the Poverty Alliance, the Commission has published a report which paints an accurate but worrying picture of housing need in Scotland and which provides a series of specific but practical recommendations for the Scottish Government to adopt. The Chair of the Commission, Robert Black, said the report described the central focus as being about the importance of having a suitable home which allows each and every one of us to live fulfilling lives and achieve our potential. But he added, "We are a long way short of this. There are about 150,000 households on waiting lists for social housing, 940,000 in fuel poverty, and over 60,000 are overcrowded. With an averagely priced house now costing about five times the average annual income, owning your own home is becoming an unachievable pipe dream for many families in Scotland, especially young adults and families." Presiding Officer, the key recommendation from the Commission is the need for the Scottish Government to oversee a radical increase in house building. The report calls on ministers to set an interim target of at least 23,000 new homes a year, of which at least 9,000 should be affordable homes. Now, given that we are currently only building around 15,000 homes a year, the lowest levels of house building since 1947, this will require strong and decisive political leadership. Is it really asking so much in a prosperous country such as ours to expect every Scot to have a safe, warm and affordable place they call home? That is Labour's vision, but I would hope it is a vision we could share with members from every political party. Mr Mason.
John Mason.
Thank the member for giving way. He seems to be suggesting that we should have more housing, which I would welcome. Is he suggesting that the government should spend more money on housing? And if so, should that come from where?
Macintosh.
The point of today's motion and using the Commission on Housing and Wellbeing is to see if we can reach common agreement across this chamber on the scale of the crisis facing us. Now, I can assure you that the Labour Party would be willing to work with and support any government initiatives which recognise the scale of that problem and recognise the scale of social rented housing that needs to be built, as well as private housing and housing across all tenures. And we are genuinely willing to work with the government if they will also recognise that we are facing a housing crisis. And I hope Mr Mason would be one of those who would be genuinely willing to work with Labour and others on this issue. Now, many housing and anti-poverty organisations would go much further than the Commission's interim target, both on overall housing and on housing for social rent. And one area which does not get much attention in the report is how we improve housing for disabled people. It has been estimated, for example, that 70,000 households in Scotland need adaptations for wheelchair users, but do not have them. There is simply not enough suitable or accessible housing being built. And it is up to the Scottish Government to increase that availability by insisting that at least 10% of housing across all tenures is built to wheelchair accessible standards. The Commission report does go on to spell out a series of further actions which need to be taken. And it doesn't shirk from identifying the major challenges facing us over the next decade on freeing the supply of land for new housing, recognising and supporting the growing role of the private rented sector, on tackling fuel poverty and stepping up the pace in reducing residential greenhouse gas emissions. Presiding Officer, these are all areas where I am confident there is at least the possibility where we can find agreement, if not consensus, across the chamber. But what worries me, and why we have posed this as a question in Labour's motion for debate today, is that it is not that clear from the programme for government that it matches the ambitions and the call to action set out in the Commission. And just for example, one of the housing announcements in last week's programme for government was the continuation of the Help to Buy scheme. Now, I think we're all pleased that the government has listened to criticisms we have made of the scheme and announced a three-year budget as opposed to annual announcements. But as Homes for Scotland have pointed out, the £195 million over the next 3 years outlined by the First Minister is significantly less than the £305 million allocated over the previous 3 years, a sum which was itself immediately oversubscribed and resulted in a stop-start situation for the industry, causing frustration and confusion for home buyers and builders alike. Homes for Scotland have also pointed out that earlier this year, the UK government committed £6 billion to extend Help to Buy to at least the year 2020. Now, based on rough calculations, the consequentials for the Scottish government would be expected to amount to some £150 million per year, as opposed to the £65 million per year announced. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary if he will explain to Homes for Scotland how he intends to use the remaining balance? Another of the housing announcements in the programme for government was on planning. And the First Minister surprised many of us, well, surprised me anyway, when she unveiled plans for a root and branch review of the planning system. Now, as the Cabinet Secretary will know, this is something I wholeheartedly support, as I don't believe the planning system is working as well as it should. It neither addresses our need to deliver new housing, nor does it give local communities the accountability, the control or the protection they wish. It is too slow and too unpredictable in outcome. I say I was pleasantly surprised, but that is because I lobbied the Cabinet Secretary himself directly as recently as March this year, when I asked him what his position, the Scottish Government's position, was on holding an independent review of the planning system from a community perspective. And the reply I received from Mr Neil did not encourage me. And this is in March. I quote directly, "Scotland's planning system has undergone the most significant modernisation in over 60 years. The overall aim was delivery of a planning system that is efficient, inclusive, fit for purpose and sustainable. The Scottish Government has no current plans to undertake a further review." And I'm intrigued, Presiding Officer. Perhaps the Cabinet Secretary will tell us what has changed in a mere 6 months to make this most significantly modern planning system, this efficient, inclusive, fit for purpose and sustainable system, now apparently so antiquated. But in the absence of a reply, I'll return to the private rented sector. The Commission on Housing and Wellbeing also flagged up the need for reform, and this is another reason why my Labour colleagues and I were pleased to finally see the Government outline proposals for a private tenancies bill. Now, since devolution and the formation of this Parliament, the proportion of Scots renting in the private sector has almost trebled, from 5% to more than 13%. And as things stand, more than 312,000 Scots households, I should say, are privately renting in Scotland, including some 80,000 families with children. By itself, that might not be a cause for worry. But research from the Joseph Rowntree Foundation has found that, and I quote, "the number of households in poverty in the private rented sector has doubled in the last decade to 120,000. And the Joseph Rowntree Foundation also reported that the gap between social and private rents in Scotland is higher than, for example, any other English region except for England. Presiding Officer, the SNP members often say that instead of criticising the Scottish Government, Labour should come forward with solutions. And I don't think it would be untoward of me to remind the Chamber that taking action to improve security of tenure and to limit rent rises in the private sector is something that Scottish Labour has been calling on for quite some time. In fact, if I may point out to my SNP colleagues, if they had voted with Scottish Labour instead of with the Scottish Conservatives to introduce rent controls in the Housing Bill last year, they could have saved Scots in private rents a considerable amount of money. Over the last few years, private tenants in Scotland have seen their rents rise on average by £200 per year above the rate of inflation, and by a lot more in the hotspots of Edinburgh, Glasgow, Fife and Aberdeen. And that's why, whilst we await detail, we hope the bill will be a positive step towards creating a more stable and secure tenancies. Presiding Officer, I've tried to outline there are some government announcements on housing which we will support, but I'm not convinced they merit the label of bold, which the Prime Minister, the First Minister tried to describe them with last week. The Commission has provided us with a call for action, and one of the strengths of its report is that it constantly makes the link between a satisfactory home on the one hand and our individual well-being and a fair society on the other. The Cabinet Secretary has made much of the impact of welfare reform and is currently working on a new social justice action plan. Well, here is an area which has a direct impact on our welfare, on our quality of life and on the prospects for our children's success. It is entirely devolved. We all know that families and individuals can prove remarkably resilient in the face of adversity if they have a safe, warm home to return to. On fuel poverty, just for example, the Commission's report highlighted that a cold home is neither conducive to good health nor a satisfactory learning environment for children nor young people. Lang Banks, the director of WWF Scotland, put it this way: it makes no sense that hard-pressed households spend scarce money on energy to simply heat the air outside of their cold, draughty and leaky homes. Yet the Scottish Government has yet to set a long-term goal for the National Infrastructure Project to bring homes up to an acceptable energy performance standard. We need to build, planning officer, I'm conscious of the time, we need to build many, many more homes, but this is more than a numbers game. So can I ask as well what the Scottish Government are doing to look at the specific neighbourhood recommendations of the report when it comes to recognising the greater role that wellbeing and community have to play when it comes to future housing policy? Presiding officer, Scottish Labour deliberately decided to focus on the housing crisis facing this country in this, our first debate following the programme for government. Ensuring everyone has access to a decent home should be the starting block in our mission to build a more equitable and happier society. Labour's ambition for our country's future are matched by our absolute determination to ensure everyone in Scotland has the comfort and assurance of a safe, secure and affordable warm home. It's not an impossible dream. It's not an unrealistic goal. What is required is political will, and I move the amendment in my name.
Many thanks. And I now call on Margaret Burgess to speak to and move Amendment 14167.2. Minister, you have 10 minutes or thereby, please.
Okay, thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'm sure we can all agree with what, a lot of what Ken Macintosh has said, and that everyone in Scotland should have access to a warm, safe, secure and affordable home. And that's the aim of this Scottish Government. And we laid that out in our strategy, Homes Fit for the 21st Century. And I also very much welcome the work that the Commission on Housing and Wellbeing has done to explore and explain the links between housing and wellbeing, and to draw that to all our attention. The Commission is a good example of the type of cross-sector working that I believe is important, and it shows a vibrant sector looking to work with each other and with government to find positive policies for Scotland. Housing, in particular social housing, remains one of this government's highest priorities, and is why we've committed over £1.7 billion of investment in affordable housing over the lifetime of this Parliament. As the official statistics published yesterday show, we are now going to exceed our target of delivering 30,000 affordable homes across the country. Over 28,000 affordable homes have already been delivered, 93% of the five-year target. And this is a significant achievement at a time of UK government-imposed capital cuts of 26%. And Ken Macintosh referred to house building since 1947, but what he didn't, he took out of that the recession and the fact he was talking about private house building. We're building more affordable homes and more homes in the social sector than any previous administration in Scotland. But this Scottish Government wants to do more. I'll take an intervention.
Ken Macintosh.
I was trying to get a void from playing the numbers game, but would the Minister accept that whatever number of houses the current government is building or are being built in Scotland by the private sector, that it does not meet the needs of Scotland's people and Scotland's communities?
Presiding Officer, I was about to go on to say that we want to do more. We want to increase and accelerate our ambitions for Scotland's housing as we go forward, and to continue to do so in an integrated and collaborative way. Our current target of 6,000 affordable homes per year is absolutely not the limit of our ambition. Presiding Officer, we will continue to support local authorities to deliver their affordable housing priorities with quality homes in mixed communities that fit local needs. And we have delivered 4,956 council homes, 99% of our 5,000 council homes target. And I am going to get into the numbers game here, because that is thousands more. In fact, it's 4,950 more than built under the previous Labour-Liberal coalition. And we have built more social housing under the 7 years of this administration than the previous Labour-Liberal administration. And I'll come to those figures shortly. We have built more social housing. That includes RSL housing and council housing. And we'll continue to work with a wide range of partners across the public and private sectors to invest in and deliver a significant supply of housing, which harnesses increased level of private finance, with value for money and public resources?
Given the seriousness of the housing crisis that we have in Scotland, should we not start to try and move beyond who did what and blame each other and actually getting on with the issue of building houses for rent, council houses that people and families in Scotland desperately need?
Minister.
I would say to the member that's precisely what this government's doing, and we're actually doing it, and we set ourselves a target and we have met that target, and now we're exceeding that target, and that's what we are doing. We are continuing to build houses for those that need it across all tenures, and that's despite the challenges we are facing in our budget, and we are determined to do it. We've already worked closely with our partners to produce a joint delivery housing plan. And the plan addresses the wide range of housing issues in Scotland, and it captures a crucial set of delivery actions which we collectively agree are vital at this time. New housing supply is one aspect of what's important, but we need to ensure, as Ken Macintosh said in his contribution, that people can afford to heat their homes and their homes provide a safe and positive environment, and homes are flexible to households' changing needs. And these last few years, high and rising energy prices on top of the UK government's continued austerity have made things very difficult for many households across Scotland. And that's why this government has sought to help those households by investing over £500 million since 2009 in our fuel poverty and energy efficiency programmes. And our efforts are paying off. Since 2008, nearly one in three of all households have benefited from energy efficiency measures, and now over a third of all Scottish dwellings has a good EPC rating of Band B and C, an increase of 56% since 2010. But housing, and again the Commission referred to this, as did Ken Macintosh, and I certainly agree, housing is much more. It's about much more than a roof over people's heads. Good housing can assist in creating vibrant communities, allowing them to flourish and be empowered. It can create the right environment to allow children to grow, learn and reach their full potential. It can ensure the health and well-being of its occupants is maintained or improved. Good housing goes right to the heart of the fairer and stronger Scotland that this government is working to deliver. And, Presiding Officer, the housing market has changed since the global recession, and this government has responded positively and creatively to provide a wider range of funding mechanisms than ever seen before, and to squeeze the maximum value from our austerity-hit reduced budgets. This has seen us support the construction sector and home buyers through our Help to Buy schemes. Our considerable investment of over £500 million over the past 3 years and the 3 years ahead will help around 14,000 households buy a new home. It will also provide the construction industry with a huge economic boost that can ensure employment in the sector. And we will work with Homes for Scotland and the sector to develop how the new scheme proceeds. And the Scottish Government continues to lead the way in innovation. The contribution to new housing supply from innovative financing approaches is substantial and growing, with nearly 3,000 new affordable homes being approved, unlocking around £400 million of housing investment. And these new approaches have seen us develop products for mid-market rent and shared equity, and seen us support homeowners facing difficulties through our Homeowners Support Fund. The availability of suitable, good quality housing and housing services make a vital contribution to the success of integration of health and social care. And we are working closely with the housing sector to deliver appropriate housing support and services. We also recognise the need to plan for the future and to ensure that we have the land and the infrastructure required to deliver the supply of new housing at the pace we would like. And the objective of the planning review announced in the programme for government is to ensure planning does all that it can to enable the delivery of high-quality developments across the country. In particular, the review will seek to identify where further targeted improvements to the planning system can be made, with particular emphasis on increasing the delivery of high-quality housing developments. And we also recognise that the housing system works differently in rural Scotland. We have listened to rural stakeholders, and in 2016, for a 3-year period, we will put in place a rural housing fund to suit the particular needs of rural areas. All of this requires working closely with partners, and we have done this effectively, as can be seen in our delivery. We have delivered 20% more affordable homes in the last 7 financial years than the previous administration. We've outperformed England and Wales in new build social sector completions and in private sector completions per 100,000 of population. We've worked with local authorities to deliver a substantial council house new build programme, with 99% of our 5-year target being met. To March 2015 been met. We've provided affordable mid-market rent options for those who seek them. We've put owner occupation within the reach of many who in the current climate were struggling to raise large deposits or access full borrowing. We've helped people insulate their homes and save money in energy bills. We've created additional funding options and routes to private finance. And we have ensured that housing investment is targeted locally where it's needed most, through local authority strategic housing investment plans. And to conclude, Presiding Officer, this Scottish Government has achieved much, but let there be no doubt whatsoever that our appetite and our drive remains to build and improve on the good progress to date. And we'll do so within the powers vested in us while remaining constrained by Westminster. We are committed to building on our substantial progress in tackling housing issues, and in doing so, working in a constructive, collaborative way with partners across the public and private sectors to deliver a fairer, stronger Scotland. I move the amendment in my name.
Many thanks. Before I call Mr Johnson, I'll just say that there's a modest amount of time in hand this afternoon. So I now call on Mr Johnson to speak to and move amendment 14167.1, 6 minutes or thereby, please.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And lest I forget towards the end of this speech, may I begin by moving the amendment that stands in my name. It's always good to have Ken Macintosh proposing a motion in Parliament. Ken is an experienced politician, and he manages to mix good traditional common sense with some good old-fashioned left-wing prejudices when it comes to applying policies such as housing. In fact, what Ken did today, in my view, was an attempt to redefine the crisis in order to fit existing Labour policy. And for that reason, I would suggest that much of the motion is a bit of an attempt to hammer a square peg into a round hole. But nevertheless, it sets out a very clear problem, and one which we are right to be debating at some length today. The issue of housing and well-being is something which has been dealt with extensively in the report, which is mentioned in the initial motion. And it's one which I think will serve to educate us, to inform us, and to define many of the arguments we have about housing and well-being going forward. Well-being, in fact, is a very interesting area of policy, and one which I'm sure we will return to. But in the short time available to me today, housing will be my key priority. The problem we face is that, of course, there is not enough money to go round. During the course of a recession, it can often be difficult. But money is not the only problem. In fact, when we look at housing and housing issues, it's surprising the amount of money which is, or at least would be, available for investment in affordable housing if the correct conditions were created. And that's why we should prioritise confidence in the marketplace as much as anything else that we do. Turning briefly to the government amendment today, I think it has to be said that it does set out the achievements of this government so far. In fact, a brief look at some of the statistics would indicate that, in spite of the fact that many figures in terms of housing are well below where they were at pre-recession levels, that positive progress is being made. The problem is that it's not big enough progress, and it's not being made fast enough. It does have to be said, however, that on perusing these statistics, one of the strangest ones that comes up, I did predict it myself, was that the sale of public authority dwellings, including local authorities with total stock transfer, rose by 20% in 2014-15. from 1,527 to 1,835. This is the second consecutive annual increase after years of declining numbers of sales. The increases are likely, in my view, to be due to the announcement in 2013 that the right to buy was to be ended for all tenants. If we look at what's happening in our housing market, there is less construction in the private sector, there is less construction in the public sector across the board, although this government will insist on telling us that it's seeing more council houses built than any of its predecessors in recent times. It is nonetheless the case that the private sector, the private rented sector, has taken up a great deal of the necessary capacity which this government has, for whatever reason, been unable to provide. The growth in the private rented sector has become the central pillar of our social housing policy. And that's why it is of concern to me that last week, and to some extent today, we've heard talk of rent capping as being a primary tool taking us forward. However, I have to say that looking at the description that appears in the amendment in the name of Margaret Burgess today, it does seem to make clear that it is still the intention of this government to take forward a modern private rented sector that is fit for the needs of today's tenants and landlords. And I will ask her, or whoever replies to this debate, if that is meant to be an olive branch to the private rented sector, because it is necessary at this stage to deliver something. I can assure the government that there is a deep-seated fear that action, the wrong action at this stage, will result in a move towards disinvestment in the sector, and at a time when we are not in a position to replace these homes with new build homes for rent, one for one, we may lose a large section of the rented capacity we have if we do not treat these people correctly. Excuse me, I'm going to come to a conclusion very soon. It is the case, however, that we must search for ambitious solutions to Scotland's housing needs, that we must find ways to increase capacity in construction across the board, and that the way that we will achieve that is to build confidence. Confidence in the market is what gave us the growth in all sectors that we had prior to the recession. A return to that confidence is what will result in that investment returning. That's why it's the job of government and all politicians, even the ones in opposition, to ensure that what we do is designed to make it easier, safer and more practical for people at every level to invest in housing. That return in confidence is key to success. It must be across all tenures and all sectors. But if we work together to build confidence, the capacity exists for our housing problems to be solved by investment which is not exclusively dependent on government or the public sector, but can also find private sector solutions. So if we treat the private investors, the private renters right, they can continue to solve our problems and deal with many of the issues in this crisis which others are confused and cannot find a solution to.
Many thanks. We now move to the open debate and 6-minute speeches or thereby, and I call on John Mason to be followed by Jane Baxter.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'd like to spend a little bit of time looking at some of the words that are used in Labour's motion. And it's probably good that we start with what we can agree on, and I have to say I completely agree that securing a decent home is very much linked to individual and also social well-being. And I hope we're all agreed that investing in housing has huge benefits, which can take people out of fuel poverty, can help youngsters educationally to study better, and can improve the health of whole families. Now, whether or not there is a, quote, homes crisis in Scotland, I think is open to debate, and that has been touched on already. I have to say, I do think crisis is a word which tends to be used very loosely in this place. And I think we would do better if we thought about it a bit more carefully before we used it too frequently. One definition of crisis I found included a crucial or decisive point or situation, a turning point. And I really wonder if we are saying that housing, while we accept that housing is a key challenge, whether we're at some point a historical turning point. I mean, housing, frankly, just let me finish this point. Housing, frankly, has been a challenge. It's been a problem for the whole of my life, both for Scotland and the UK. And realistically, it is going to continue to be for some time, whichever party is in power. But I think to use the word crisis too loosely is a mistake, Mr. Macintosh.
I recognise the point that Mr. Mason makes. Does he also recognise that the word has not been used by the Labour Party in this context? It's been used by Shelter Scotland, by the Commission and by Sir Robert Black.
Yes, I mean, I do accept that, and I suppose my general point is not just in this place that we use crisis too loosely. I think maybe we use it more widely. I mean, if we're talking about refugees and immigrants these days, then I accept that that would definitely be a crisis and the correct use of the word. Now, positively speaking, I have to say that in an area like Greater Easter House, where I live, the state of the housing is generally much better than it was 25 years ago when I moved in. And in turn, even at that time, it was so much better than the tenements with the shared toilets and huge overcrowding that had happened after the war period. So let's be realistic that huge progress has been made historically before this government came to power and since this government came to power. But at the same time, I have to accept that housing is still the main issue that constituents come to see me and my office about. So there is no question that we do have an ongoing challenge. Can I say too that I think we should give credit to the housing associations in the work they have done and continue to do in doing their very best to find and create suitable homes for tenants as much as they possibly can. But they are limited, the housing associations, and we are limited as a parliament in what can be done by the resources, primarily meaning the money that is available to us. There are certain inescapable facts here, including that Westminster's mismanagement of the economy, which has led to a reduced Scottish budget, and that has been made worse by the Tories cutting harder than they needed to. So we do not have as much money for housing as we want or need. And if, as I challenged Mr. Macintosh earlier, if the opposition are saying that they want more money for housing, then they have to be honest and tell us where they want to take that money from. For example, is it less money for health and hospitals? Or is it less money for schools and colleges? Or is it less money for transport? Because surely it has to be one of these. Now, if... Okay.
Ken Macintosh.
Does Mr. Mason accept that one of the reasons I haven't put money in this motion was to try and get recognition that there is a crisis, a problem facing us, and to try and reach agreement? If we cannot agree on the scale of the problem, we will not agree on the solutions. Does the member agree that there is a crisis facing housing that needs us all to work commonly to address it?
John Mason.
Well, I think he knows already that I agree, and I think the Housing Minister agrees that there is a problem and there is a challenge. I do not accept that the word crisis is the right word to use at this time. But for individual families, I accept that some of them are facing a crisis. Now, going on from if we're not going to cut expenditure somewhere else, can we raise it, for example, through taxation? And next April, clearly, we do start having power over income tax. And frankly, I would be delighted to tax higher earners more and use the proceeds for investment in housing. But we have to remember that 1p more tax for the richest would mean 1p more tax for the lowest earners. And I think we do have to think long and hard before we go down that route. Now, if I'm speaking about housing, you will not be surprised that I mention my own constituency, and particularly one of the huge housing issues at the moment, which is the Commonwealth Games Village, with its 400 social rented houses and 300 owner-occupied, most of which are now occupied, although the care home has still to come on board. And so my first point on this would be to emphasise the tremendous enthusiasm with which this development has been greeted. We have disabled people now having a suitable home for the first time, larger families who are no longer overcrowded, and even folk moving into the area from areas like the West End, which I think some people used to believe was more desirable. And I touched point there with Mr. Johnson's point about building confidence, and that's exactly what the village has done and is doing, and we hope to see more private developers coming into the area shortly. Have I got a little bit of extra time here, Presiding Officer?
Yes, a moment yes. Or so.
Now, of course, new housing developments this size do have teething problems, and we have had some of these. some residents already not looking after their gardens. The council has refused to install litter bins because the roads are not yet adopted. But these are relatively minor in the scheme of things. And overall, it has been great to hear from new residents how pleased they are with their homes. Now, the motion states that buying our own home is increasingly unaffordable, and sadly, that does seem to be the case. Can I say that I see this as very much linked to the wide gap between the richest and the poorest in our society? If we have a more even distribution of income and wealth, then more people would be able to afford an ordinary home. But if some people are so rich that they live in a huge mansion or even have several properties, then the corollary is that other people are squeezed right out of owning at all. So helping people at the bottom end of the scale has to be linked to redistributing the income and wealth of those at the top. Other issues raised in the motion include quality standards and rent levels, and I would suggest that quality standards are a challenge, in fact more of a challenge, in the owner-occupier and private rented sector, where some of the worst conditions prevail. By all means, let's have rent controls if necessary and give more security to tenants, but improving the standard and safety of private rented properties has to be a high priority as well. Linked to this, I think we need to go further with factoring at some stage, perhaps having compulsory factoring and potentially compulsory maintenance funds. So, Presiding Officer, by historical standards, huge progress has been made. I very much welcome the progress that has been made by this government, and in the words of some of the local housing associations, let us complete the good work that has been done so far. Thank you.
Thank you. Now call on Jane Baxter to be followed by Gil Patterson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I should like to begin by declaring an interest. I am a private sector landlord in Fife, and I'd like to put that on the record before I begin. In recent years, we've seen a vast increase in the number of people who rent privately in Scotland. Since the formation of the Scottish Parliament, the proportion of people who rent in the private sector in Scotland has almost trebled, from 5% to 13%. And yet 100,000 of households in the private rented sector live in poverty. Private renters in Scotland spend nearly a quarter of their income on housing, far more than is acceptable. A recent report from the Joseph Rowntree Foundation found that, I quote, "The number of households in poverty in the PRS has doubled in the last decade to 120,000, while the number in social housing has almost halved to 190,000. At the start of the 2000s, poverty in Scotland was predominantly in the social rented sector, but this is no longer the case. Two-fifths of households in poverty live in social housing, compared to three-fifths a decade ago. Meanwhile, a quarter live in the private rented sector, up from 1 in 10. Many people have little choice but to rent privately. They cannot afford to save for a deposit to buy a house, and the options for social housing may be limited in their locality. Scotland is facing a social housing crisis. We need massive investment in the supply side of housing, which would see construction of social housing to boost our economy, access to safe, secure homes for thousands of families, and all the improvements in health, well-being and increased community cohesion and safety in communities across Scotland that would come with those new houses. An affordable, safe home is a fundamental component of building a fairer Scotland. Since coming to power, the SNP have cut the capital housing budget. I'm proud to say that Labour is committed to building at least 20,000 homes a year between now and 2020. In Fife... Yep.
You're committed to building 20,000 homes. Can you give an indication of what that's going to cost and how much of the Scottish budget that will cost?
Baxter.
Well, no, I'm not in a position to do that today. I would echo Ken Macintosh's comments that these are things we need to work on together. An example of how these things can be funded, though, is what I was going to go on to say, which is in Fife Council, they've committed to building 2,700 houses by May 2017, and they're on track to do that. And they did that by consulting with tenants and raising the rents and using the increased income from that to raise the funds to build those 2,700 houses. So there are ways of financing increased house building. In Fife, there's been collaboration between housing providers, housing associations, private developers and a number of Scottish Government initiatives, and that target is on track. Together, they're delivering modern, fit-for-purpose, energy-efficient homes. And where possible, the Council's new build properties are allocated to existing tenants whose current home is not suitable. And then that existing home is freed up to allocate to someone else on the housing list. And this chain of lets means that 2.4 households' housing needs are being met for every new council house let. And this approach is making serious inroads into Fife's housing problems. On top of that, Innovative and fast solutions are necessary if we are to deal with our housing crisis. And again, I refer to Fife. We've recently seen a very innovative project where we've been rebuilding on existing foundations. Sharp Construction, with support from Fife Council and Ore Valley Housing Association, have speedily and safely built new homes on the foundations which are originally laid for houses which are no longer fit for purpose. So they demolished those not fit for purpose houses and built on the funds. This process was hugely collaborative with local people and has broad local support. It's just one of many new approaches that could be used to tackle Scotland's housing crisis now. But for those who cannot or do not want to live in social housing, we need to reform the private rental sector to make it work for everyone. In the worst-case scenarios, the sector is at risk of just being a cash cow for landlords. Not this landlord, but for landlords. But the priority for all of us must be to meet the needs of families who are either unable to get a foot on the property ladder or access to social housing. Shelter's Make Renting Right campaign has cross-party support. It makes bold calls for action on rent levels and security of tenure. It calls for stability for people wanting to make rented housing their home, flexibility for people to stay in their home as long as they need, a modern tenancy that gives security and flexibility for both tenants and landlord, a fair system for sorting out renting problems when they occur, and predictable rents for tenants and landlords. What is clear is that tenure options in Scotland are in desperate need of reform. It's a positive step that the Scottish Government have committed to making changes, but we must wait to see the detail of the proposals. The various tenures currently available must be rationalised and made to work for everyone in Scotland. Another area in which there is little doubt that Scotland's private rented sector does not work is in rent levels. Scotland has a larger gap between private and social rents than any region of England, bar London. The Scottish Government's own expert working group on welfare recommended mandatory rent caps written into all leases in June 2014. The Scottish Labour Party welcomes in principle the private tenancies bill that the Scottish Government has set out in its programme for government. One section of this bill will include reference to some rent controls. Scottish Labour has been arguing for action to control rent rises for months. Indeed, we tried to amend the Scottish Government's last housing bill to that end, but were voted down several times. And since that bill was passed, rents have again risen. Had the SNP Government acted in 2013, when its last private rented sector review took place, the average Scottish renter in the private sector would have saved over £150 per year already. The SNP voted against proper rent controls three times and are now only proposing the far narrower, to quote the First Minister, provision of more predictable rents and protection for tenants against excessive rent increases, including the ability to introduce rent controls for rent pressure areas. The SNP rejected Scottish Labour's proposal for real rent controls in the last housing bill and have now come forward with watered-down proposals. In their 2011 manifesto, the SNP provided a guarantee to retain secured tenancies at affordable rents, but private rents have increased by over 3% year on year in Scotland. It remains to be seen to what extent the proposals put forward will achieve this goal, because the housing crisis in Scotland needs radical and innovative solutions. The Scottish Parliament will be given sweeping and wide-ranging new powers that could be put to use to tackle the housing crisis. Housing benefit reform, the building of tens of thousands of new houses and radical action on rents must be top of the agenda to ensure that people across Scotland are able to live in decent homes. Thank you.
Thank you. Now Colin Gill-Paterson, to be followed by Malcolm Chisholm.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer. It's most gracious of Labour, the Labour Party, to bring a debate to the Scottish Parliament today on housing and wellbeing using their own time. It comes as a bit of a surprise to many of us, particularly since Labour, whilst in government, had such a woeful record, having only built six council houses in the whole time they were in power. That is six council houses in a staggering 8 years. However, I'm sure the public will be exceedingly impressed if Labour were to say they intend to double their record, yes, to 100%, and the public are bound to be wowed over this promise to build 12 council houses over 8 years. Well, I don't think so. Now, of course, I must labour the point. Six houses in 8 years only added to the shortage in the quality council housing that was already a disaster created by the Tory failed plot to bribe voters to their cause by bringing Right to Buy. Something, again, Labour did absolutely nothing about. No, wait, it gets even worse. They actually continued the Tory master plan to rid Scotland of availability, quality council housing. If you want to witness the effect of the dual impact of reduced numbers of quality council houses and the almost criminal lack of new build council houses, I invite the Parliament to my constituency. Evidence lies there aplenty. Contrast Labour's record with that of the SNP. Now, we need to really remember that up until 8 years ago, Labour owned Scotland, or at least they thought they did. Just in eight short years of an SNP government, a government with no experience whatever in these matters, from a standing start since 2009-10, over 5,350 new council houses have been built by the SNP. Over and above that, 34,500 socially rentable houses have been completed. That is nearing a fifth more than Labour did over the same number of years. We don't need only to measure this government's record on social housing against previous devolved governments in Scotland. We can look further afield, and the positive message on delivery for Scotland continues. The Institute of Fiscal Studies has highlighted that the Scottish Government spends a whopping 85% more per head on social housing than in England and Wales. The result of this investment has seen a rate of social sector completions per 100,000 population being significantly higher in Scotland at 65.3 for the year to the end of September 2014, but in Conservative-run England it was only 44.7. If that's not bad enough, the rate in Labour-run Wales is 24.6. However, there is always a catch when you do good work in Scotland. London has yet again put in the usual penalty clause like some rogue insurance company. We are being penalised by Westminster for investing more in social housing because the benefits of that spending accrue to the UK government in the form of lower housing benefit payments. That aside, this has not deterred the Scottish Government for one second in doing the right thing, in doing all that they can to assist our people get the housing they deserve and need. With the announcement in the programme for government that £195 million will be provided over the next 3 years to help more people buy the new build homes, this will see at least 6,500 families supported to buy a new built home that meets their needs, and most crucially, at a price that they can afford. The Help to Buy scheme has already helped 7,500 households in Scotland buy a new home over the past 3 years. I'm sure I don't need to say we need to do more. It's quite clear, of course, we need to do more, much, much more. But it's equally clear that with the actions that this government has already taken and the record that they have, that this government won't sit on its laurels. And I'm confident it will do all it can with the powers and the budget that it has available to remedy the quality housing shortage that we have. Presiding Officer, I thank them for their efforts and their deliverance in their work. Thank you.
Malcolm Chisholm, followed by Bob Doris.
Officer, both Ken Macintosh and Jane Baxter reminded us that the number of people living in private rented accommodation has almost tripled during the years of the Scottish Parliament, and I want to speak mainly about that subject today and illustrate with an example which has been a major issue in my constituency over the summer. But first, I would like to make 3 points about social rented housing in the City of Edinburgh Council area. Firstly, there are on average about 200 people that apply for every social rented house that becomes available in the City of Edinburgh Council area, and I don't think there's any local authority in Scotland that can match that shocking statistic. So secondly, I do hope that the Minister will take more account of that reality in the funding formula for distributing housing money and not be misled by the great success of Edinburgh in relation to mid-market housing. Now, that is important. and it counts as affordable housing, but it is not suitable for the very many people who need social rented accommodation. And the third point I would make is about the long-standing issue of housing association grant. When I went to the 40th anniversary event of the Port of Leith Housing Association last week, once again, that was the issue that they highlighted to me. Housing association grant, the grant for each new social rented house, plummeted 2 or 3 years ago, was partially restored a year or so later, but is still significantly below what it was in 2007, shall we say. There has been a group reporting recently which has recommended that it should be further restored, and I hope the government will act on that as soon as possible. But moving on to the private rented sector, I strongly agree with the and support the Shelters Make Renting Right campaign. And of course, the first problem is the short-term nature of private rented tenancies. Now, I welcome, as far as they go, the proposals for the new private rented housing bill, and we'll look in detail at those, but I do have concerns that they may not go far enough and that the 6-month short assured tenancy may still be the norm in Scotland. And I did prefer and was disappointed not to see, for example, the proposal that UK Labour had before the general election for 3-year private tenancy agreements being the norm. So I hope the Scottish Government will consider that. A constituent sent an email to me recently and said, I quote, "The private rented sector is not geared up to provide long-term stable accommodation that folks and families can make their homes, and the insecurity of the tenure makes stable life impossible and results in much disruption for tenants." And of course, rents compound the problem because many need to constantly move because rents increase beyond what they can afford. Again, we have some proposals for the bill based around pressurised areas, but I would hope that the minimum should be that there should be no rent increases in any year beyond inflation, and I would like that to see the minimum. Now, the repairing standard was some progress for the private rented sector in the 2006 bill, but I now believe we need to move to a common housing quality standard. And I'm glad to see that at least the Scottish Government is committed to consulting on a minimum energy efficiency standard for the private sector, and I hope the Minister can tell us when that consultation will be launched. They've also have a consultation currently on a letting agent code of practice, and I think it's very important to make clear that upfront letting fees charged to tenants are unlawful, and regulations must be strong enough to see that agents who don't meet the required standards are struck off the register. So we need a strong register for letting agents. We have one for landlords, and again, I would urge the Minister to look at that to make it stronger, because there are still many issues where private landlords are not meeting their responsibilities, for example, towards common repairs or keeping their gardens tidier, where many, many issues, and it seems that there isn't the power under the landlord registration legislation for action to be taken on that. Now, many of these problems are illustrated by a landlord in my constituency, which happens to be a charitable trust, and which has decided to evict in due course over 200 tenants whose rents have paid for the Trust's charitable purposes over many decades. The tenants have asked for a 12-month moratorium on sales so that they can pursue a co-op option or other suitable solution, but only 4 months have been granted, which is not enough time for such a complex situation. And crucially, the Trust is determined to only sell in a way which realises the highest possible receipt, disregarding their obligations to the tenants, many of whom have invested their own money in the homes over decades. There is surely a certain irony in a trust making people homeless in order to give more grants to homeless and other charities, and I cannot believe that is what the 2005 charity legislation intended. It will break up a highly successful community in the Lorne area, a community with many families and older people and rich social networks. There are also major issues about the state of the properties and the failure over a long period of time to repair and upgrade them adequately. Moreover, there are big questions about the behaviour of the letting agency in question, which assured several tenants about the security of their accommodation, attempted to move some elderly and vulnerable tenants from assured to short assured tenancies, and has recently stepped up its inspections in preparation for sales, but with increased stress for tenants. Supporting these tenants in every way I can has been one of my top priorities over the summer months and will continue to be so. There is an amazing tenants group at Lorne with some wonderful and determined campaigners. And more than anything, I hope that they will be able to continue living in their great Lorne community.
Thank you, Mr. Chisholm. Can I just point out to members, we have got a little time in hand. If you wish your remarks to run over a little bit, I will try to accommodate you. And of course, if you wish to take interventions, I will add time at the end. So, Bob Dorris, followed by Alice McInnes.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. This debate on housing does not take place in a vacuum. It takes place in the face of an austerity onslaught which has devastated public funds for capital investment in the last few years. Less cash to build, quite simply, means it's challenging, to say the least, to build more homes in the face of a collapsing budget. Surely that's common sense. It's not defensive on behalf of the Scottish Government. It's just plain common sense. Now, Mr. McIntosh, on behalf of Labour, said he did not want to descend into a partisan debate exchanging statistics, and neither do I. It is reasonable to put on record where there has been significant achievements, Mr. McIntosh, significant improvements of the Scottish Government despite capital cuts. So housing waiting lists have fallen every year for the last 6 years, and they are down 10% since 2007. That's an achievement. More homes have been built in the last 7 years than were built in the 7 years before that. Surely that's an achievement. And finding £1.7 billion in the face of the cuts that I mentioned to invest in affordable housing, and it looks like we're going to meet our target of 30,000 affordable homes very shortly, that's an achievement. So let's recognise success where it has happened, but let's also face up to the challenges that we have going forward. And can I say quite honestly to Labour that I want to look forward to future success and progress, but we can't close our eyes to what happened in the past, the good things and the bad things, the successes and the failures, because we have to actually learn about what worked and what didn't work to decide what our options are going forward. So sometimes when MSPs from this side of the chamber chastise Labour for what we feel is your failures and lack of success, we have to identify what went wrong, show what we are doing right, and then we can build on that together. That's not partisan. We can't close our eyes and pretend the history didn't actually happen. Yes?
Michael McMahon.
I thank Bob Dorris for making that point. Does he therefore agree that when his colleagues refer to Labour only building 6 council houses, that that is really stretching the argument beyond any recognition? And the fact is that Labour built a substantial number of social rented housing at the same time. And the comparison between the number of social housing now and when Labour was in power is less significant than his colleagues would try to pretend it was.
Bob Dorris.
I think somewhere within that intervention there's a concession that there's far more social and affordable housing under this Scottish Government's record than under the last Labour executive, and that's in the face of significant capital cuts. Surely that's a success. And it's just a fact that there were 6 council houses built in 4 years by Labour compared to over 5,000 in this administration. So clearly we are doing something right to drive forward the expansion of council housing in Scotland. And I suspect the right to buy axing, the ending of that, is a significant driver towards that. So we have to put that on the record and learn from our successes and the failures of other people that we've rectified those ill-considered ideas. Yes?
Patricia Ferguson.
Will the member accept that one of the reasons why Labour-controlled local authorities and other local authorities too, not controlled by Labour, couldn't build houses was because of the right to buy? That was only revoked at the point at which Labour reformed the right to buy in an earlier session of the Parliament. What we did do was put the money into social housing in other ways, through housing associations. That is the fact of the matter.
Bob Dorris.
I thank the member for the intervention. She mentions that's the fact of the matter. I would strongly disagree with that, but don't wish to get into the partisan argument that myself and Mr. McIntosh seek not to do. The record is quite simply over 5,000 council houses from this government and 6 under Labour, and people can do the maths themselves, quite frankly. Let me give some consideration in relation to where there has been challenges, some successes and where we could go forward in the future. This Scottish Government took a decision, I think it was Stuart Maxwell was the Housing Minister at the time, to consistently cut the Housing Association grant budgets. Quite simply, if you could get more houses for a smaller subsidy in the face of cuts, that's what was done. And that fell quite dramatically. And it was successful, but I have to say, Presiding Officer, we then amended the Housing Association grant and gave it a small uplift again to get the optimal efficiency in relation to delivering social rented homes. I hear some laughter over on the Labour benches, but it's this Scottish Government that will make the best use of taxpayers' money in the face of Tory cuts and challenge austerity to deliver for tenants in Scotland. I don't have time, Mr Macintosh, I'm sorry. Can I go on to talk about housing churn and how we could perhaps not solve housing need, but better address housing need with the allocations policy in local authorities. Let me tell you about a couple of constituents of mine. Let me tell you about a constituent in the Balgrey Hill High Flats in Springburn, who was offered a house that would have met their housing needs, and they were in a dire housing position. But they were very, very worried that once they were moved to that house, they would be stuck there, and they'd be stuck there forever, because the allocations policy, quite often the social rented sector, doesn't lead to housing, housing aspiration as part of it, and that has to be addressed somewhere down the line. Let me tell you about another constituent, Saracen Cross in Postle, where we were able to identify a possible house for that constituent, which would have improved their housing situation, but wouldn't have met all their housing needs. So the Housing Association didn't want to move them to a house that didn't meet all their housing needs. Just two examples of how housing allocation policies could be used more effectively. A churn in the movement to improve everyone's housing needs a bit, but don't close off the door or the route to housing aspiration in the social rented sector. And I think that's something we have to look at. In the time I've got left, Presiding Officer, I want to talk, it's not just about building houses, it's about where you build houses, and it's about building communities. In Somerston, where I stay, and I have to declare an interest because I'll be affected by the Glasgow City Council plans in the Black Hill Road area across Somerston, through to Eastern Bartonshire and up to Lamb Hill, where Glasgow City Council has decided that all the Green Belt will now be moved over for housing development, to rezone it for housing. Now, they actually decided not to do that until the landowners appealed that decision, and it now forms part of the local authority plan. I've objected to that, and I very much hope that will be overturned at the reporter stage in terms of plans. It's not just about building houses, it's building about communities, and where local authorities have got a responsibility to play their part in that, and they don't always get it right.
Thank you. I call Alice McInnes, followed by Sandra White.
Oh, thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I won't be alone amongst my colleagues here in Parliament in handling more casework about housing problems than about any other issue. A sadly familiar litany of problems cropping up over and over again. Inadequate housing, overcrowding, high house prices, exorbitant private rents, long waiting lists for social housing, families stuck in temporary accommodation, damp homes, neighbourhood problems and fuel poverty. And yet, however familiar the problems, I'm never in any doubt about how damaging and wearing it is for each individual constituent that I see, and my own anger and frustration at our collective failure to tackle these problems grows. Housing problems wear people down, stress affects their health, debt grows and creates further problems, and families are pushed to breaking point. Councils, struggling with growing waiting lists, force families to make invidious choices. A mother in temporary accommodation, having fled an abusive relationship, who comes to me distraught because the council has told her to widen the search for social housing. And she explains to me that if she does so, she will need to move the children from a school they're settled in and away from family support in the village. A homeless family who have been offered a council house 30 miles away in a small town with no public transport links to where they work. A single parent in private rented accommodation who spent years fighting to get the educational and social support her disabled son needed, finding herself facing eviction, and the only homeless accommodation offered by the local council means uprooting her son from that support network. Week in, week out, my surgeries underline that housing and wellbeing are inextricably linked. We all know that, and yet still it seems that housing policy is dealt with in a silo. So it's welcome that the Labour Party has chosen to use their debating time today to consider the Commission on Housing and Wellbeing's report. The focus on wellbeing and the emphasis on considering in the round a range of interrelated issues such as housing, neighbourhood, economic activity, health and environmental sustainability is a profoundly different and indeed a very welcome approach. The Commission has stressed the central importance of having a safe, secure and suitable home that allows people to fulfil their potential and for that home to be embedded in and linked to a strong, vibrant local community where people can live good lives. That chimes well with the Liberal Democrats' aim of enabling every citizen to achieve their full potential and contribute fully to their communities. Now, the Commission concludes starkly that there is, and I quote, there is very clearly a home crisis, and goes on to make a series of worthwhile recommendations. And yet both the Government amendment and the Conservative amendment choose to delete all reference to a homes crisis. You know, deleting words in a parliamentary motion won't solve the problem, won't take away from the fact that this Government has failed to provide housing for the 10,000 households who are currently in temporary accommodation. In temporary housing, not just for weeks or months, but for years. Just last year, local authorities gave us the grim numbers of people who waited for more than 5 and indeed more than 10 years after they applied for social housing. Presiding Officer, as of May last year, over 13,000 households had been on the waiting list for more than an entire decade. What clearer indication is there of the Scottish Government's failure to adequately respond to the housing shortage crisis, leaving children to spend Christmas after Christmas in houses that they can't call home? And while the Government claims that in the course of this 5-year Parliament it will have built more than 30,000 units, housing completions do remain at still 40% less than before the economic downturn. 16,000 new build houses were completed in the year ending. Yes, of course, Minister.
The Member, in talking completions, will recognise that in terms of affordable housing, there is more affordable housing being built under this administration than previous administrations, and she is referring to the private sector and the recession.
One of the things that concerns me is the constant conflation of affordable housing and social housing. Affordable housing does not mean social housing, and social housing is where we really need to start making a difference. If you'd like me to make some progress now, 16,000 new build houses were completed in the year ending March 2015, compared to 25,000 in the same period before the SNP took power. And the Government can continue to blame the economic downturn, or it can figure out a way to help those in need of a place to live. And I think that's the spirit of Ken Macintosh's motion today. And I would rather see us actually discussing how we collectively solve this problem than bandy about figures back and forward. But the facts do speak for themselves. Of the 30,000 completions over 5 years, only 2/3 are intended for social housing, which falls short of both the Commission's and Shelter Scotland's recommendations for at least 10,000 new homes for social rent to be built each year to start to meaningfully tackle Scotland's housing crisis. So that means we're at 30,000 social housing units that haven't been built so far that have been identified as needed. Turning to the announcement of a successor plan of the Help to Buy scheme, I welcome that, but I urge the Scottish Government to provide details as soon as possible. While we've seen the positive 9% rise in the total number of new build houses, we must recognise that it's largely because of the predecessor to the scheme and the private build sector itself driving progress. As the Right to Buy scheme is being brought to an end in April of next year and its expiration date is nearing, it makes the release of information for the Help to Buy scheme even more urgent. In the North East, the housing shortage affects not only individuals but whole communities, with teacher and healthcare worker shortages exacerbated by the lack of affordable housing, putting strain on public services. We also need to consider innovative solutions to provide for the growing number of households headed by persons aged 65 and over, projected in the report to increase by 50% between 2010 and 2035. Presiding Officer, in addressing the houses shortage in Scotland, we need to heed the findings of the Commission on Housing and Wellbeing. A house, an education, a respectable healthcare, these are the issues that we need to tie together. But guaranteeing that each person has an appropriate, safe, warm house is the foundation stone for giving each individual a chance to experience the best standards of life.
Thank you. Sandra White, to be followed by Patricia Ferguson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I'm looking forward to this debate, and I do thank the Labour Party for bringing this debate forward. I think if one of the most important things that anyone can have is a decent house and a decent home, a warm, dry home. I remember many, many years ago speaking at a conference in Europe when I was, I think it was deputy convener of housing in the SNP many years ago before I was even in this place, and the way they dealt with rented accommodation in Europe was so entirely different the way they deal with it here, particularly even to do with the funding as well. And for many years I did push forward for that type of funding to go forward. So I think it's very apt that we are debating this today, and I do want to thank the Commissioner on Housing and Wellbeing for the report and the fact that the members of the Commission come from a wide range of backgrounds. In fact, it's written in the report, their own admission, that only one member comes from a housing background, and I know that member, and I think he's a very, very good spokesperson for the housing movement as well. So I think it's excellent that they have had a broad sweep in regards to the Commission, and obviously the amendment by the Minister, which said it's a very good example of cross-section working, which I'm sure all of us will welcome in that respect. Presiding Officer, I do commend the work carried out by the Scottish Government in reaching 96% of their target for building homes for social rent. Indeed, since 2007, I think it's been mentioned already, a total of 54,186 affordable homes have been completed. However, I think we all recognise that, yes, we do need more socially rented accommodation. We do need some changes in the law, particularly in the private rented sector as well. And we do need to work with various agencies, such as housing associations, local councils and private landlords, to achieve this. Now, a number of members have mentioned the planning process, land release to enable houses to be built, and of course it must be looked at, as is the release of brownfield sites. And I do remember the Scottish Government have mentioned the fact of brownfield sites in my own area, and Glasgow City Council has also mentioned the release of brownfield sites and building on these sites. But the problem, particularly in my own constituency and perhaps throughout Glasgow, whilst it was mentioned to build in brownfield sites to bring people into the city, actually there's not that many brownfield sites within there to bring people and to build houses on that. And I'll elaborate a bit on that further on. In fact, if it comes to fruition, which I hope it does, and we do get more houses, it will not be within a city centre setting. It will be out with the city centre, and I think that's something we've got to take on board. I wanted to raise an issue in regards to my own constituency, Glasgow Kelvin, and we're mentioning the brownfield sites and bringing folk to live in that area. But I think perhaps most people who live in Glasgow, Patricia Ferguson and others, will realise that the only, and I'm sure they know that, that the only properties being built are private student accommodation, and I know Bob Doris is aware of that also, so much so that there is absolutely no land available in my Kelvin constituency for social housing. And that's a big question which I know that the Minister's probably fed up with me writing to her, as is Glasgow City Council also. And I note the Commission's report in regards to communities. I think it's section or recommendation 19 in regards to neighbourhood and communities. And that's a very, very important aspect of sustaining communities. And I think Bob Doris mentioned it in his contribution also. And the problem we have in my constituency in Glasgow Kelvin, that we have had thousands upon thousands of houses, student accommodation built on this particular area where no social housing can be built. And it means that when there's semester time, then these become ghost areas. And I'm not talking about places out with the Kelvin constituency. I'm talking about places within Dumbarton Road, Bath Street, the city centre. And these are not cheap student accommodation. They're not on campus, they're off campus. And I can't understand why Glasgow City Council continues against the wishes of the local residents, which we're supposed to be consulting, against their wishes, continues to give permission for these to be built. Now, an example of a couple of these is you can buy one, you can buy a pod for £160,000. That's not student accommodation, that's somebody trying to make money. And as I said, I've spoken to Glasgow City Council. I can't understand why they keep getting permission for it. Nothing whatsoever against students. I've met with the Glasgow students and the universities there also. And they're not using these accommodations. So I met with the developers and I asked, why is it that you're not building social housing or any other type of housing? The answer I got back was the banks will not lend on anything else. The interest rates people are getting from the banks is so low that they're buying into the student market because the returns are so great. So that's part of the recession that we've been talking about, and it's part of speculation, people getting the money back. But it doesn't, you know, do anything to enhance the areas where people actually live. And I will thank Vivian Nicol of the Evening Times, who did an article on the student amount of student accommodation, particularly in the West End, in my constituency. And she did say, maybe it's about time Glasgow City Council consulted with the residents there. Because believe you me, it has become so bad that when it comes to the summertime, there will be no communities left in these particular areas. And that's something I think we need to desperately look at. Perhaps we don't have the powers here in that respect, but we need to encourage developers to build socially rented housing. We have some cracking, oh, sorry, a very Glasgow phrase, a very Glasgow phrase. We have some very good, I'm sorry, I'm on my last couple of seconds, Drew, sorry. We have some very good housing associations. Partick Housing Association wanted to buy an area where they could move in, move their offices and build rented accommodation. The council sold it to a private developer and it became another 1,000 student flats. So I just think to yourself, I don't know how we get over that, but I think we need to look at this in the aspects of the people who live in an area and to make sure the communities do grow and flourish. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Patricia Ferguson, followed by Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Like most elected members, my post bag is dominated by the issue of housing. And in 16 years as an MSP, this is a pattern that has not changed. What does change over time is the type of housing problem I hear about. I won't rehearse today all of the housing issues that are brought to me, as I'm sure that they're the same or similar for members across the chamber. We will all be aware of them. And as has been recognised in the report of the Independent Commission on Housing, access to a decent home is essential to an individual's social well-being. And the lack of decent housing can have far-reaching consequences, not just in terms of social well-being, but in all aspects of an individual's life. Now, for almost all of my life, I've lived in the constituency I'm now privileged to represent, and I've witnessed at first hand the changes, good and bad, that have occurred in housing over the years. The slum clearance of the 1960s, when high-rise living and new towns replaced insanitary Victorian tenements, the growth in the housing association movement that helped to give local people a greater say, and the radical move to stop transfer, relieving Glasgow of the historical debt that had stifled investment. In 2015, in my constituency, we're embarking on another period of great change, and the lessons of the past must inform our actions in order to improve the housing and the housing situation for all of our citizens. Housing provision must match aspiration and need if it is to work. And we're now seeing local people being consulted about what they want and need in their constituencies through consultation events and planning charrettes. And I know the Scottish Government has been involved in much of that work too. So housing is no longer planned in isolation, and that has to be a good thing. Happy to, Mr. Dorris.
Bob Dorris.
I'm just wondering, I know you're the local member for Mary Hamilton Springbourne, do you feel the people of Somerston were consulted adequately in relation to the city plan change? We'll see the entire Greenbelt area be redesignated for housing use without anything to supporting amenities or the environment.
Chris Ferguson.
I will, Mr. Dorris, come to that point later on in my speech, if you would just bear with me, because I do plan to talk about that a little. It seems to me that Glasgow City Council's imaginative approach is outlined in its new residential development report. The Council plans to build 25,000 new homes over 10 years, and with the Glasgow Credit Union, will introduce a mortgage guarantee scheme to help those who wish to own their own home. I'm working with the Wheatley Group it will deliver 1,700 new homes by 2022. The Wheatley Group has already been involved in building new homes in Royston, Sighthill and Maryhill in my constituency as part of the reprovisioning programme. And they now have plans for a further 125 new homes in the Milton area of my constituency, which will be a good first step in the regeneration of that area. One of the points I've consistently made over the last 16 years is that Milton has a number of brownfield sites that really should be the focus of attention for developers. Unfortunately, developers are more attracted to greenfield sites, and I think we need to find a way to incentivise the use of brownfield sites over the use of greenbelt land. And I have consistently, over the last 16 years, been against and opposed every single proposal that has come from Glasgow City Council to build in the greenbelt in my constituency. Now, that's not always popular, because people ultimately go and live on the houses that are built on that greenbelt land, but that's my position, and I stuck with it over time. The Maryhill and Sighthill areas in my constituency have been designated as transformational regeneration areas, and we are now seeing new housing in both areas being let to tenants, which is incredibly welcome. And in addition, it's planned that a memorandum of understanding will be signed with Scottish Canals and will increase regeneration around the Forth and Clyde Canal area in North Glasgow. And this will include a third phase at the Butney and Maryhill and, working with the big partnership, new private sector housing at the site of the former Diageo factory at Port Dundas. Again, something that's very welcome. From the city deal, the sum of £898,000 will be released for the canal and North Gateway, allowing sites to be prepared and made ready for development. And if I could just say to the Minister, I've spoken to two of her predecessors now about the possibility of an area of land which is actually owned by a government agency, the site of the old Rockhill Hospital, and whether or not we can't have a way forward there that allows Scottish enterprise to take advantage of the new road built by the local authority for the new school in the area, and to use that as part of the remediation and reuse of that area of land. I very much hope the Minister will agree with me on that. Finally, Presiding Officer, consultation has now begun on the future of the Red Road site once the iconic flats there are demolished in October. My own community consultation exercise in the area indicates that people want to see new housing, but they also want to see job opportunities and community facilities that will serve the people who will live there in the years to come. Now, at its height, the estate at Red Road housed around 4,000 people. And for those of us who lived there then, a school and some shops seemed to be an afterthought. We were provided with state-of-the-art housing, yes, but there were no community facilities until some years later. One of the reasons why, in my view, the estate did not succeed in the way it might have done. So it's clear to me that Glasgow is leading the way, making dynamic partnerships both with the Scottish Government, with the housing associations, with the credit unions in the city, and with Scottish Canals. And it is using its access to the city deal to make sure that the north of Glasgow is at the heart of its regeneration policy in the next 5 to 10 years. That, of course, is very welcome, but it does demonstrate that it isn't just about good, decent accommodation. It has to be, if it's going to succeed, about all the other aspects that have to accompany that: good community facilities, good infrastructure, and a mix of housing that means that people have the houses that they need and the houses that they ultimately aspire to. Too often we find people who cannot be housed in the size of accommodation they need, in the location they need, and that is one of the areas that I think we have to focus on in the years ahead. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Claire Adamson, to be followed by Paul Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've listened with great interest to the debate this afternoon and have recognised that this is not a new problem in housing, but I hope that I'll be able to demonstrate that this government has at its heart not just the availability of housing, but also has done a considerable amount of work in improving the standards of housing, and as I hope it's reaching its ambitions set out in Scotland's Sustainable Housing Strategy of 2013 about the types of houses we should be building in Scotland. It was Nye Bevan who said at the post-war house building time, at that time, said, "While we shall be judged for a year or two by the number of houses we build, we shall be judged in 10 years' time by the types of houses we build." And I think that the quality and type of housing is as equally important as the numbers in getting it right for Scotland's communities. As a Central Scotland MSP, I have in my area the former Ravenscraig site, and on that site, the British Research Establishment have their Centre of Excellence. It's an innovation park that's developed on the former steelworks, and this site is to show and showcase sustainable housing for the future with energy, sustainability, affordability and community at their heart. Very relevant, as there are potentially 3,500 houses to be built on the Ravenscraig site. If I could highlight some of those buildings, the site was opened by Alec Neil in 2012, and there is a demonstration house by Apple Green Housing, which is designed to reduce the input of energy, water and other resources while minimising the generation of waste and other environmental disturbances. They've used technologies from around the world to assist communities in achieving sustainable builds as well as ongoing sustainable living. The houses are built out with the site, usually sourcing local factories and local SMEs to provide the housing, and they are put there on the site, which puts money back into the local housing and the community through the jobs that are generated from Apple Green developments. There is also the Zero Waste Scotland site, plot number 5, which is a resource-efficient house. Environment Secretary Richard Lockhead launched the resource house on the BRI site in September 2013. It's one of the first projects to be delivered by the Scottish Government's Resource Efficient Scotland programme, managed by Zero Waste programme, and it's built in partnership with Teak Green Limited. This is another example of a house that will lead to at least the gold performance levels in terms of efficiency and fuel efficiency. Every element of this is a net zero carbon house, and it's been created with the need to lessen the impact on the environment from any house build. It's built to the 2016 Scottish Building Standards gold performance requirements and working to the 2014 Waste Scotland regulations. It's a modular house, and it shows the principles of resource efficiency with the aim of bringing sustainable, affordable and repeated family housing models to the construction market. The site also contains a refurbished house. This is a retrofit demonstration with Edinburgh University and Historic Scotland. It has used retrofit techniques, and it's currently replacing, because we're replacing our housing market and redeveloping existing sites, it's imperative to improve the performance of existing housing stock in order to reduce the CO2, to meet our CO2 reduction targets. So this is something that will feed into the building industry and show best practice on how to retrofit and retrofit solutions that work in the long term. There's also a curriculum house designed and developed by the future builders and designers of our country in conjunction with New College Lanarkshire's CAD Architectural Design and Construction courses. And there's also a timber house in partnership with the Forestry Commission, which will showcases innovative use of homegrown timber products and the ability to use local and local products to ensure that we have low embodied energy, healthy and thermally efficient dwellings in Scotland. And the reason that I highlight the BRE and the importance of the work that they are doing is that I know that this government, the Scottish Government, is absolutely committed to reducing fuel poverty. Since 2009, the Scottish Government has spent over £500 million on a range of fuel poverty and energy efficiency programmes, helping over a third of all Scottish homes to meet performance criteria. The energy efficient programme SEEP will aim to improve in a multi-year funding to improve energy efficiency of all Scottish buildings, both domestic and non-domestic. The Scottish Government has also committed an unprecedented £119 million to the fuel poverty and energy efficiency budget, and that will split between home advice and also a variety of home and energy efficient programmes in Scotland. So not only is the Government delivering on its capital build and delivering new build housing, it's also looking at how we can create sustainable, fuel efficient and effective homes for Scotland going future, in the future. If I could just touch on some of the issues raised in the debate. Alex Johnson talked about how he had concerns about how the socially rented sector might react to rent controls. I hope he'll also pay attention to the effect of the DWP welfare reforms on that sector. We visited, as a committee from the Welfare Reform Committee, Inverness to see the pilot of the universal credit being rolled out there, and there were concerns that showed that the average rent arrears for non-universal credit tenants was around £200 in the area. But when you went into universal credit, that rose to £1,000. But in temporary accommodation, particularly serviced by the private rented sector, the average was £2,100. And the reason for that was the inability to pay directly to the landlords anymore, and also some of the concerns regarding the time limits, where if somebody moves tenancy between their universal credit payments, one landlord could end up receiving the full amount. So I hope he will pay attention to those concerns that are also being raised about DWP. Do I have any more time, Presiding Officer?
But another 30 seconds.
30 seconds, OK. Bob Doris was right to say that can't take this out of the context of austerity, because not only this government having to deal with slashes in its capital build budget and also deal with the austerity agenda, it's having to mitigate for council tax benefit and bedroom tax and the other problems that are coming their way. But in terms of comparison, I'm not going to compare this with what was done in the past. If you look at the rate of social sector completions in Scotland per 100,000 of population, Scotland sits at 65.3 per 100,000. In Wales, where Labour are in power, that's only 24.6. And I would suggest that this government is doing everything it can in the current climate to meet the housing needs of Scotland.
Thank you, Ms Adamson. I now call Paul Martin, followed by Jim Eady. I will be equally generous with time.
President Officer, can I first of all touch on the contribution from John Mason, where he refers to the fact that we should be concerned about using the term housing crisis. Well, can I just remind John Mason, if you're one of those 140,000 applicants waiting to be rehoused, and many of them, I'm sure John Mason's heard representations from at his surgery, then I think they will see it as a crisis. If you find yourself homeless and not able to access the housing they require, then that is a crisis. So I'm less concerned about the word crisis being used in the comfort zone of this debating chamber and the words that we used, and more concerned about the action that's taken to follow on from that. And can I also refer to comments from Bob Doris, who asks for a period of reflection on what Labour got wrong and what they got right. I didn't hear from Bob what the SNP have got wrong, but he advises me that that's the case. Perhaps he wants to come in an intervention to tell us what he got wrong. I'll bring him in a second, but just to clarify the point that I'm going to make, I think what Labour got right was writing off the housing debt in Glasgow and ensuring that people who lived in Glasgow were able to access good quality housing as a result. Give me a second. As a result of the debt housing write-off. And also what we got right was investing in communities via the community-based housing association model, a proven record, and ensuring that we moved from a municipal system that was in place previously in Glasgow City Council and moving to the community-based housing association model. I make no apologies for that, and I'm very proud of Labour's record in that respect. I'll allow Bob Doris to come in and confirm what the SNP have got wrong.
But you do that, two things the SNP got and one thing Labour got wrong. So yes, we revised our Housing Association grant figures a bit too low and we adjusted it higher again, as I said earlier on during my speech, and we didn't take forward everything in firm foundations following further consultation. So there's reflection on the SNP. What Labour got wrong was insisting that housing stock transfer in Glasgow must go en masse and bypass local community housing associations, and Labour should be ashamed of that fact.
Paul Martin.
President, also, I think housing should be in the democratic control of local people, and that's the decision that local people took in respect to Glasgow, and they did by a large majority. And I've got to say that despite the artificial divisions that have been created by Bob Doris, the Housing Association movement, led by the GHA and by Martin Armstrong, and led by the community-based housing associations across Glasgow, want to work with the GHA, and that's the way forward. And that partnership approach should be encouraged by the government and not discouraged. And, President Lawson, I'd like to pay tribute to those housing associations who have stepped up to the plate despite the challenges that they've faced. And I'd like to name a few of them: Mullenbeck Housing Association, NG Homes, all of those that John Mason referred to in Easterhouse, Bartomwick Housing Association, East Hall Park, Proven Hall, Well House, the GHA, the Wheatley Group. Since the 1970s, these organisations have been ensuring that regeneration takes place in their local communities, and they have to be commended for the role that they have played in that respect. It would not have happened in many cases without them. And I defy anybody to visit Glasgow and visit many of these housing association properties and not be able to identify the very fact that those houses are housing association stock. And that's something that many people have recognised on a number of occasions, and the number of interventions that have taken place via housing associations and local regeneration and ensuring that social enterprises are in place. They have done that despite the challenges that are faced. And I welcome the apology from Bob Doris in respect to the housing association grant level that's been reduced, because they should apologise for it. So since 2007, there has been a significant decrease in the number of new bills that have been carried out via the community housing association model. And I'm pleased that Bob Doris has apologised for that today, because he should be apologising for that, because that community-based housing model actually works. And I defy anybody to go back to the new build properties that have taken place. I'll take you to Millennium Close in Easterhouse that looks as if it was built yesterday, but it was called the Millennium Close because it was built in the year 2000. Those properties have been sustained and well managed because local people are in control, and they have been discouraged by this government's current approach to managing housing and ensuring that those organisations are provided with the appropriate resources. President, also, on a positive note, I'd like to welcome the Help to Buy scheme that I think has been a success. I recognise there are a number of challenges in ensuring that the qualifying criteria in respect to the Help to Buy scheme should be addressed. There are many challenges. We should be ensuring that those who are at the lower end of the earnings market should be able to access the Help to Buy scheme. But can I ask the Minister, on reflecting on the correspondence that we've received from Homes for Scotland, they are still awaiting, halfway through the new financial year, information on what the Help to Buy criteria will be. Can the Minister not advise us, 6 months on from what should have been a new launch of this programme and the £185 million that's been confirmed, can she not tell us what the qualifying criteria will be? Because it is not as having an impact in the local sales that are taking place across Scotland. And if you meet with the developers, and not many of them I make a case for in this chamber, I think there are many challenges facing the developers that I don't have great sympathy with. But I do recognise that the Help to Buy scheme is one that's been a success and one that should continue to be encouraged. So I ask the Minister today in her closing remarks to confirm what action will be taken in ensuring that qualifying criteria is taken forward. Can I just say in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I always welcome a housing debate in here, but it needs to be one that will ensure we'll take forward many of the challenges that face us and those 140,000 people that are waiting to be rehoused. And it's not a laughing matter for those individuals, Bob Doris. It's a serious matter. If you're on that housing list, waiting on the government intervening to ensure that you can get a decent home, it's no laughing matter, and this chamber should ensure they take action.
Jim Eady.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I too welcome the opportunity to take part in this debate, and like other members who have taken part this afternoon, I commend the invaluable work of the Commission on Housing and Wellbeing.
The Chair of the Commission, Sir Robert Black, has said that the work of the Commission is about the central importance of having a safe, secure and suitable home that allows people to fulfil their potential, and a home that is embedded in and linked to a strong, vibrant local community, such as those that were described in the speech by Paul Martin and others, where people can live good lives. That aspiration, that vision for the role of housing in our society is one that I share and which lies at the heart of the Scottish Government's own approach. Indeed, in fairness, it is one that lay at the heart of Ken Macintosh's speech this afternoon when he set a consensual tone. He has clearly learned the truth of the old adage that you can catch more flies with honey than you can with vinegar, although I suspect that is a lesson still to be learned by other members across the chamber. But investment in housing is critical, as the report itself outlines, to enabling individuals to achieve good health, access educational opportunity, provide care for older people, and to ensure economic well-being through employment and income. Investment in housing will also allow society to achieve its ambitions in the areas of environmental sustainability and in building strong and cohesive communities. The Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee, which I have the privilege of convening, will host a session next month in which we will invite representatives of the Commission and other stakeholders within the housing sector to engage in a roundtable discussion on their findings. And of course, all members are welcome to attend that. The Scottish Government's own record is a good one. The evidence for that can be seen in the £1.7 billion which has been committed over the lifetime of this Parliament. It can be seen in the House Building Programme, which will build 30,000 affordable homes, 20,000 of those for social rent, over the lifetime of this Parliament. And it can be seen in the fact that council house building is at record levels. In fact, it is at a 25-year high. And as someone who grew up in a council house and spent the first 21 years of their life in a council house, I believe that council housing should be at the heart of a mix of housing tenure, rather than being seen simply as a safety net for those who cannot afford to rent or buy. And the Commission has pointed to the fact that almost 500,000 homes in Scotland have been sold under the right to buy. And given the massive diminution in the council housing stock which this represented, as well as the fact that councils were unable to spend the capital receipts on modernising existing housing stock or in building new council houses to replace those that were sold, I believe that this simply underlines why this policy was not sustainable and why the Scottish Government was right to end the right to buy. Another key finding of the Commission is that 50% of all households renting in Scotland in 2013-14 received financial support to help pay for their rent, and that housing benefit spending in Scotland now is in the region of £1.8 billion in the year 2011-12, a 29% increase from 1996-7. And housing benefit has become the main mechanism for helping low-income households meet their housing costs. The Commission have highlighted that housing policy has shifted over the last 30 years from predominantly subsidising social house building to providing income-related subsidies to poorer tenants in rented accommodation. The ratio has moved from 4-1 in favour of housing supply subsidies in the 1970s to the same ratio in favour of income-related subsidies today. And how we bring about a shift back to subsidising bricks and mortar rather than means-tested personal housing subsidies is a challenge I believe we must address. And this can only come about if we continue to expand subsidised housing supply and therefore help to make rents more affordable and reduce the need for personal subsidies. Sandra White, in what I thought was an excellent contribution, highlighted the fact that financial institutions are willing to lend to property speculators who are investing in student accommodation but are unwilling to lend to the social rented housing sector. And I think that that is an issue that needs further exploration. The Commission has highlighted a number of areas, of course, which we would do well to reflect on. And one of these is the issue of temporary accommodation. I was pleased that during the passage of the Housing Bill, that the Housing Minister, following representations from myself, Shelter Scotland and Alec Rowley, brought forward the Homeless Persons Unsuitable Accommodation Scotland Order 2014, which states that, and I quote, in all circumstances, accommodation is unsuitable if it is A, not wind and watertight, and B, not suitable for occupation by children. And that was to ensure that all temporary accommodation is fit for human habitation. So I welcome the Commission's reference to temporary accommodation when it says that there should be a significant reduction in the length of time any one household spends in temporary accommodation, and minimum standards for temporary housing should be implemented. And I look forward to further work on that. The key area, of course, is that of maintaining existing levels of investment and to build on that in the years ahead. Clearly, if as a society we invest more, we will achieve more, and the Commission has made a number of specific recommendations in this regard. They have recommended that the Scottish Government should increase the level of new building funded by the Affordable Housing Investment Programme to 9,000 houses each year over the period up to 2020. That the social rented new build programme should be increased to 7,000 houses each year, which would represent an increase of 3,000 over the current level, and that there should be a doubling of the mid-market rental new build programme, which together with the existing level of grants for new owner-occupied houses could provide 2,000 new houses each year. Now, clearly, it will be for the Scottish Government and for all of the parties represented in this chamber to reflect on these recommendations. It is open to any party through the budget process to bring forward proposals to increase investment in the way that has been suggested, but there is also a clear responsibility to outline how that will be paid for and what other funding commitments will have to be cut in order for that to happen. The point which I think was made earlier and effectively by John Mason. Parties will in due course bring forward their manifestos for next year's election, and in a sense the report of the Commission could be looked upon as an opening bid for what should be in them. The Commission has recognised, and I quote, that public finances are likely to be under severe pressure for some time, with difficult choices required. Presiding Officer, we should not shirk those difficult choices. We should heed the call to action issued by the Commission so that we can continue to deliver high-quality, affordable homes for the people of Scotland.
Many thanks. Now move to the closing speeches, and I call on Cameron Buchanan, a generous 6 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I too welcome this opportunity to discuss the importance of quality, affordable housing, as well as to clarify the intentions behind the Private Tenancies Bill and the consequences it could have. Whilst I support the principle of providing security for tenants and safeguards for landlords, I would not endorse some of the intrusive measures under consideration. A provision to remove the no-fault ground for repossession, I think, would severely deter investment in the private rental market, as it is too sweeping and would in any provision allow rent controls. Furthermore, the quality of housing in the private rented sector could be severely damaged, and this would plainly not be in the tenants' interest. That is what we must focus on, the genuine best interests of tenants and the long-term sustainability of this sector. Certainly.
John Mason.
I mean, I wonder if the member would accept that the quality of housing, not in every case, but in more cases, is substandard in the private sector, and there needs to be more intrusive rather than less intrusive regulation.
Cameron Buchanan?
Yes, I do accept that, actually. I do think that's right. And I think there's an argument for that. We all wish tenants to receive a fair deal and should use robust evidence to determine the context and most effective way to ensure that the market is affordable and fair to all participants. On this note, I think it is worth bearing in mind that evidence shows rents in only two of Scotland's broad rental market areas exceed the CPI inflation between September 2010 and September 2014, effectively meaning that rents have fallen in real terms over this period. In three of the areas, rents have even fallen in cash terms. I think it is indeed important that access to affordable housing is available, but the approach should ensure that the supply of properties matches rent demand. To do this, it is clear that Scotland needs more homes to be built, but this must be done through a clear planning process that strikes the correct balance between meeting housing needs and respecting local priorities. Let me start by saying that all parties want access to quality, affordable housing to be available throughout Scotland, quality as well. This should be the target without predetermined intrusions, and I would welcome more clarity from the Scottish Government on their intentions. Where homes fall short of official quality standards, action should be taken. But it is important that consequences are analysed extensively before any damaging measures are enforced. So whilst tenant security is important, it would be wrong and highly counterproductive to remove the no-fault ground for repossession. Not only would this be, I think, highly unfair and worryingly dismissive of landlords' rights, but I think it would encourage damaged confidence, it would also damage confidence in the sector. More importantly, make landlords increasingly reluctant to let out a property, which I think is vital. Take the example of a retired couple who depend on income from a property to fund their retirement. They may rent it out in the knowledge that they could sell should they wish to at the end of a contract. Without the no-fault grounds, this couple would no longer be in control of their own retirement income, which would be extremely unfair. For them, furthermore, it is likely that many landlords in a similar situation would choose not to rent out their property, with therefore fewer properties available to rent. Tenants would be noticeably worse off in their search for a home. A fairer, I think, and more workable alternative could be to introduce a more accommodating approach to tenancy agreements that would allow participants to decide for themselves the ideal balance between security and flexibility. Similarly, any provision to introduce the rent controls or caps will again be against tenants' best interests. This may notionally sound like a good deal for tenants, but the reality would be very different, and I think disastrously so. With rents unable to adjust to market conditions, potential landlords may choose to divest from the rental sector, both in terms of making property available to rent and maintaining the quality of those available. It would hardly be in tenants' best interest for fewer properties to be available, and worse, maintain ones at that. Indeed, as Shelter's chief executive has stated, that although many have called for rent caps as a solution, we have found that this could add fuel to the fire by pushing landlords out of the market and making it even harder for renters to find a home they can afford. The fact is that there is more demand for homes than there is supply. The long-term solution must therefore involve increasing the supply of housing. Disincentivizing investment by landlords would obviously not help with this. What we do need, I think, is a properly thought-through development of all types of housing. However, this is often where contentious planning processes are crucial. Refusal of all contentious planning applications is neither viable nor a realistic option. But our communities and local representatives are not powerless, or at least they shouldn't be. Yet, as we Conservatives revealed recently, the Scottish Government overrules local authorities more often than not when appeals are taken to ministers. This is not how we should go about striking a balance between the community's needs and securing the quality homes that our growing population requires. There is certain scope to improve the planning process so that developments are more likely to be welcomed by local communities. And I await the proposals of the Scottish Government's review with considerable interest. What is already clear is that development driven by central government appeals is not the answer. Presiding Officer, I would like to underline our drive to secure a rental market that is fair, competitive, and in all participants' best interest. It is in this vein that I would strongly oppose any provision within the Private Tenancy Bill that restricts the ability of landlords to decide for themselves when to rent out their own property and dangerously distorts rent and investment dynamics with rent controls. The quality of rental homes should be ensured by encouraging rather than discouraging investment, and affordability must be secured by a long-term increase in the housing supply. To achieve this, it is apparent that restrictive measures measured on landlords should be avoided, and the planning process must be reformed so that it encourages sustainable development whilst respecting local needs. Thank you.
Thanks very much. I now call on Margaret Burgess. Up to 10 minutes, please, Ms. Burgess.
Okay, thank you, Presiding Officer. This has been a wide-ranging debate, and it's very clear to me that across the Chamber we all agree on the importance of housing for Scotland's people and communities. Good housing has a positive impact on people's health and wellbeing and in neighbourhoods, as mentioned by Sandra White, I think Paul Martin and a few others about the neighbourhood as well, about how important that is. But I want to say something, and opposition have been very careful throughout this debate not to talk about how much it costs, how much it's going to cost, how much we should set aside for housing. But we can't discuss housing and house building without talking about the finance as well. And I have to say that we've already said that our commitment of £1.7 billion is providing 30,000 affordable homes in the lifetime of this Parliament. And that's despite cuts to our capital budget. And we know our budget's going to get further squeezed by Westminster. So we're having to look at other ways of using the financial transaction money and other ways of attracting finance into house building in Scotland. But I think it is right for me to say that even with those squeezed budgets, we are building more houses for social rent and affordable housing than was built by any previous administration, and that includes houses built by RSLs. In total, the social housing built by this government in squeezed budgets is greater, 19% higher than those built by the previous administration with rising budgets. In terms of affordable homes, we've also improved the number of affordable homes being built. We've built 15,327 as opposed to 9,000 by the previous administration. And we have to look at that, and we have to look at how hard we are working to build more homes given the constraints in our budget. And I don't think it's fair to talk about it without talking about the budget. I would much better appreciate it if the opposition came and said, this is what we think should be spent in housing, and this is where, as John Mason said, this is where we think you should take the money from within the Scottish Government budget. I'll take an intervention.
Michael McMahon.
Ken Macintosh, in his contribution earlier, asked the question that has been asked by Homes for Scotland about the Help to Buy scheme. Based on the consequentials that were calculated as coming through that scheme, there was an expectation the figure would be around £600 million. Now, we appear to have an allocation of £195 million over 3 years. Where is the rest of that money? Has it been allocated to housing?
The spending review is not completed. What we have said is that we will allocate £195 million to help people buy a new build house, and that's in addition to what we are doing in terms of social houses and affordable houses. That is in addition to that. We've already assisted over 24,000 people buy a house, and Ken Macintosh said it's a pipe dream for people. We are assisting people buy houses as well as providing the houses for social and affordable rent, and we're using a number of initiatives. We're making best use of that money. 3,000 affordable homes being approved through a range of innovative financing mechanisms with the National Housing Trust. We're the first and remain the only government in the UK and public sector body in Scotland to use charitable bonds to build affordable and social housing. We've enabled pension funds to invest in affordable housing, and we hope this can roll out across the rest of Scotland. We're also in the private sector. We've supported Homes for Scotland building the rented sector project, focusing and attracting institutional investment into Scotland's new build private rented sector. We continue to do that. We're also, in response to, I think, Alison McInnes, the Aberdeen Key Workers Scheme, where we're looking at working with local authorities to provide affordable housing for key workers where the rent's in pressured areas. So local authorities determine how many homes they need to look at. We talked about the elderly and accessible housing, and again, we're looking at that with local authorities in terms of they have to look at. We've made it clear that they must look at that when they're producing their local housing strategy. And Adamson mentioned the Green Homes Innovation Scheme. We're also looking at that as how we can provide more homes that are greener, energy efficiency, and cost people less in fuel bills, which is something that we're all keen to see. And I think every member mentioned in their opening remark, like the Housing and Wellbeing Commission, that joint working across all sectors is the template that underpins the approach to improving Scotland's housing. And groups such as the Joint Delivery and Policy Group and the Homelessness Prevention and Strategy Group clearly illustrate our intent to work together. And we very much appreciate the work of our partners in this, local authorities and housing associations, which Paul Martin referred to, that we were in some way trying to disassociate from housing associations. We very much welcome the work of housing associations. They're a key partner to us. We recognise the work they do in their local community. They are community anchor organisations. I'll give way.
Paul Martin.
Clarify for the record, I didn't say you disassociated yourself from them. I said you didn't fund them. That's the challenge. It's ensuring they get the appropriate funding to do the work they need to do.
Margaret Burgess.
Okay, you said we didn't fund them. We are funding housing associations. We work with them closely. We increased the grant to housing associations when they... We increased the subsidy to housing associations, and we have still built more houses, RSL houses, than under the previous administration. And we also have got the report from the subsidy group that we're currently looking at just now. We work very closely with the housing association sector. We recognise their role as a community anchor, and they also receive funding for many of their subsidiaries and many of their projects in from the People and Communities Fund. We recognise very much the wider role they play.
And Macintosh?
Can I just clarify? She said that the government has increased the funding to housing associations on HAG levels. Bob Doris earlier apologised for cutting it, which is right.
Minister?
No, I think Bob Doris didn't apologise, and he certainly didn't apologise on behalf of the government. What we did is that we... on very much reduced budgets, and we and the pressures on the Scottish Government to build houses, and very much reduced budget, the subsidy to housing associations was reduced. They still built houses with that reduced budget, and we absolutely appreciate the work they did in that. However, I set up a subsidy group when the housing associations came and said this is not going to be sustainable any longer. We then increased their grant to the recommendation from that subsidy group, which include the housing associations and the community housing associations. There's been a lot of talk on the private sector and what we're doing in the private sector, and we very much continue to take action to reform the private rented sector to ensure it does meet Scotland's housing needs. We want to ensure that the private rented sector is properly regulated with the interests of landlords and tenants fairly balanced, so there is no olive branch. That was the intent of our intention in the private sector, to ensure that we safeguard landlords as well, because as Ken Macintosh has said, as Alison McInnes has said, and as others have said, we need the private sector. It is part of our housing system, and we need to ensure that we can attract investment into it as well. I mean, it's absolutely essential that treating people... I'll give way.
Johnson.
A number of speakers, particularly from the Labour benches during this debate, have suggested that rents in the private rented sector are rocketing, or they've given that impression. However, there seems to be evidence that suggests while surveys of advertised rents for property coming to the market may be rising, that in reality, rents paid in the private sector across many areas of Scotland are stable or in some areas actually falling. Does the government have figures that can inform that debate, and will it be possible for them to be made available to us if they have anything that we don't have already?
Minister.
If the government has figures, the figures will be publicly available on that. And as Alec Johnson has just said, there are some areas that the private sector is stable, but we are very much aware there are areas, hotspot areas, where rents are increasing considerably. And we are looking at that, and that's why we looked at rents in the private tenancy bill and why we've put a provision in the bill for capping rents in those areas. So we will shortly be introducing the Private Tenancies Bill to Parliament, and that bill will provide security, stability and predictability for tenants while giving landlords, lenders and investors the confidence to continue investing in the sector. And I believe that this will achieve what Shelter are calling for in their Making Renting Right campaign. The new tenancy that we propose represents a significant transformative change and will enable tenants to better assert their rights and help them to feel part of their local community. And I'm sure when Malcolm Chisholm sees what we're proposing, he will be happy with what we are doing, given what he said. Now, as I'm about running out of time, I just want to kind of finish by saying that last week I was speaking at the on the government's record on housing at a Chartered Institute of Housing Finance conference. And many of the organisations there were worried about the changes that the Conservatives plans for Conservatives plan for England and their impact on social rent budgets. And there was real concern that this would have a knock-on effect in Scotland. And I could assure them that we have absolutely no plans to mirror the UK in this. Here in Scotland, we highly value and promote social housing and social landlords in our communities. And it was clear that this
value that we place on social housing was viewed very positively, especially by those out with Scotland who are having to fight to maintain social housing. When we have people from outside Scotland wishing that their representatives followed our lead, I think we can take some satisfaction that the measures we're putting in place are right. But what matters at the end of the day is that people in Scotland have a warm, safe and affordable place to live that meets their needs. And that, presiding officer, is the ambition that this Scottish Government has for housing in Scotland.
Thank you very much. I now call on Michael McMahon to wind up the debate. Mr McMahon, you have until 5 o'clock.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I recently discovered statistics that show that the number of vulnerable children in Scotland waiting for a home has increased by 400 in the last year, and that the number of children in temporary accommodation now stands over 4,500. Now, I reiterate that statistic this afternoon to do no more than highlight the shocking human cost of Scotland's current housing crisis. The point I want to make is that there is an undeniable crisis, regardless of the SNP's strenuous efforts this afternoon to deny that fact. When we're seeing hundreds more children having to live in temporary accommodation because of a social housing shortage, there is nothing else that situation can be called but a crisis. So when debating the housing situation, fine, let's use statistics. Let's make our arguments from differing perspectives and offer various solutions. But let us at least come together and agree the fact that Scotland is facing the biggest housing crisis since the Second World War. It really was regrettable, although predictable, to hear the Minister and others on the back benches talk about the Council House versus Housing Association straw man argument. There really is no place for that argument when we are talking about the number of people who are waiting on housing lists. Bandying figures around from 1999 in different circumstances, from the difficult circumstances that the current government finds itself in because of financial pressures, does not help that debate to move forward. We have to focus on what's required now, not use statistics as Gil Paterson did. You're entitled to have your own opinion, but you cannot have your own facts. So I sincerely thank Shelter Scotland. Can I make some progress first? So I sincerely thank Shelter Scotland for establishing its Commission on Housing and Wellbeing. Let us listen to what they have to say about this crisis and let us commit ourselves to responding positively to the findings of the report that they recently published. As the Commission stated, although many households in Scotland live in satisfactory housing, we quickly came to the conclusion that there is a homes crisis. Obviously, John Mason didn't hear that message. He sounded more like Jim Callaghan. Crisis? What crisis? But when you see statistics that they produced of 150,000 on waiting lists, 940,000 in fuel poverty, 73,000 in overcrowded accommodation, 29,000 homeless people, and 40% of social housing falling short of the Scottish housing quality standard, these are statistics that demand action and not platitudes and not spin. More than, yes, certainly.
I hear what the member is saying about historic statistics, but will he recognise that the Institute of Fiscal Studies have highlighted that the Scottish Government spends 85% more per head on social housing than in England or in Wales, where Labour are in power?
Well,
again, it's a statistic that I accept, but when you're comparing apples and oranges, it's hardly a very good argument to bring to a debate about what's happening in Scotland. And the reality is that more than ever, we need real honesty when discussing this issue. And that has been sadly lacking, and it happened again this afternoon in this debate. The fact is that the Scottish Government has failed to tackle the slow rates of both social and private sector house building, and we have to recognise that. But however, in asking the Scottish Government to be honest, I'm also going to be forthright myself and concede that no government has ever really built the numbers of homes that have been needed. That's why Labour will now focus on how we can build both affordable homes and more social housing. Historic trends in new builds showed peaks in the early 1950s and the late 60s, resulting primarily from programmes of post-war reconstruction and some clearances. Programmes for which Labour is immensely proud. But Labour also has to recognise that progress was not sustained when we had the opportunity. More recently, while the figure for the year to December 2014 was up by 4%, that only helped us reach 15,541, which is still 40% below the post-devolution peak left by Labour and the Liberals in 2007. Now, that is simply not good enough. So we must have answers to the questions that house builders are asking so that we can promote house building to the levels that are required. And we did hear some of those arguments this afternoon. Sandra White was absolutely right to talk about the difficulty of finding solutions in urban settings, especially city centre locations. But we shouldn't have a council of despair either, because there are innovative ways out there that we could be taking as examples of how to address that problem. And we heard some of them from Patricia Ferguson and from Paul Martin. We have to identify how many more homes can be built and explain how this will be funded. The Minister was absolutely right to make that point. But this is where a requirement for even more honesty comes in. The additional sums of money we require to maximise the potential house building we need to address the problem our country faces may have to increasingly come from private finance, for example, via pension funds. As the Commission on Housing concluded, we will also have to consider tax changes and other measures to improve the supply of land for housing if we are to genuinely tackle this problem. So, just make a point first. And I agree with Homes for Scotland, who have argued that our planning system also needs to be reviewed so that it helps rather than hinders house builders. Mr. Mason.
I thank the member for his letting me in. I mean, he says about perhaps money coming from other sources, but essentially that is still a loan, isn't it? That even whether it's from a pension fund or a bank or from anywhere else, it's effectively a loan. It needs to be repaid. It needs an interest rate return. So how does that help actually build more houses? We still need grant, don't we?
Mr. McMahon.
You've completely missed the point, Mr. Mason. It's an investment by a private institution into the building of houses. That's not a grant to anyone. It's an investment from the private sector. That's what we have to talk about. That's the kind of initiatives we have to discuss. I know the Minister is going to come in and talk to us about Falkirk, but that is the type of thing that we need to be investigating.
Yeah. Cabinet Secretary Alec Neil.
And we've been at this for 5 years with the pension funds. The problem with the pension funds is, if they were to fund the entirety of the houses being built by the housing associations, the rate of return from the current level of rents would not be enough, and that's part of the reason why they're not investing to the level I would agree we should try and attract. So in order to do it all by pension funds, you would need to increase the rents very, very substantially, well above their current levels.
Come on, man.
The Cabinet Secretary missed the point and said they didn't all have to come from finance. It's an example. It's an example. The Commission also reported that a cold home is neither conducive to good health nor a satisfactory learning environment for children and young people. There is a particular problem of potential hypothermia for older people who are unable or unwilling to pay to heat their homes to an adequate level. This highlights the need for improving the energy efficiency of homes to be a key part of the Scottish Government's approach to improving the well-being through housing policy. And I totally agree with Claire Adamson on this, and also commend the excellent work being introduced by BRE at Ravenscraig. But like the existing Homes Alliance Scotland, I welcome the Scottish Government's recent commitment to make energy efficiency a national infrastructure priority. A similar approach was a Scottish Labour Party policy in our manifesto for the 2015 UK general election, so we are glad that the Scottish Government is following our lead yet again. However, the Scottish Government has not yet set a long-term goal for the national infrastructure project. The Commission on Housing recommended that regulations requiring owners to insulate their homes should have a part to play in securing the necessary improvement in insulation standards. The existing Homes Alliance has also for some time supported the use of regulation in that regard, and I have to admit I see a lot of merit in the argument that they make. However well we construct our homes or improve existing stock, we must first and foremost build the number of homes that people need. To begin with, I'll ask the Minister again, can she explain why, based on the consequential fundings we expected to receive from the UK Government, the Scottish Government would have received £600 million overall for the Help to Build Fund,
yet they've only announced £195 million over 3 years. Can the Minister explain how the balance of funds is intended to be used, and is it still in the housing budget? Shelter have suggested it would require £200 million to meet their target from the Scottish budget. Will the Government commit to that type of funding? This is a vitally important question, and the Minister can't duck it any longer.
The Minister can't intervene either. I'm afraid you're in your last 20 seconds.
Yeah. So I'll conclude, Presiding Officer, because by again returning to the Commission. I can't find a better way of drawing this debate to a close than by endorsing the conclusion of Robert Black and his team on the Commission on Housing and Wellbeing, where they state that they have delivered a call to action on one of the most serious and challenging issues facing Scotland now and throughout the next decade. They do not wish their report to sit on a shelf. Faced with the current crisis in housing, I can assure you that we on these benches will not allow that to happen.
Thank you. The next item of business is a debate on motion number 14189 in the name of Angela Constance on the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act 1974, Exclusions and Exceptions, Scotland Amendment Order 215. Any member who wishes to speak in the debate should press the request to speak button now, and I call on Angela Constance to speak to and move the motion. Cabinet Secretary, 8 minutes.
Presiding Officer, I want to begin by thanking you, business managers, committee conveners and members, and parliamentary officials for your support and cooperation in facilitating an accelerated timetable for scrutiny of this order, amending the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act 1974, Exclusions and Exceptions, Scotland Order 2013. It is in the public interest to help minimise the disruption to the operation of higher-level disclosure checks and thereby minimise the risk to public safety. Members may be aware that higher-level disclosure describes the overall system that allows for additional scrutiny of a person's criminal convictions. It is used, among other purposes, where someone wants to work with vulnerable groups, for example, in a nursery, as a medical professional, or in a school, or where someone wants to work in a sensitive area, such as offering financial advice. And there are two aspects to the higher level disclosure system. Firstly, it operates through individuals being responsible for disclosing information. And secondly, Disclosure Scotland issues certificates containing conviction information held on central police records. And under this system of additional scrutiny, the information which must be disclosed by the individual and Disclosure Scotland includes convictions which have become spent under the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act 1974. This information would not ordinarily be disclosed to an employer, but it is under the higher level disclosure systems as it currently stands. And the operation of these two areas can be seen as mutually reinforcing, with information given by the individual in, say, completing a job application form able to be checked by an employer against information contained in a higher level disclosure, such as a standard or enhanced disclosure certificate or a protecting vulnerable groups PVG disclosure issued by Disclosure Scotland. In June 2014, the UK Supreme Court found that the system of higher level disclosures, as it operated in England and Wales, breached a person's Article 8 rights under the European Convention on Human Rights. Although the court fully accepted the need for additional scrutiny of a person's background if that person wanted to work with vulnerable groups or in other sensitive roles, the court considered that the automatic, indiscriminate requirement for disclosure of all spent convictions was not proportionate, as no assessment of the relevance of the information to the need for the disclosure was undertaken. And while the decision related to the law of England and Wales, we have considered its relevance to the higher level disclosure system in Scotland, informed by developing thinking and case law in England and Wales and Northern Ireland on how the balance of competing rights and interests should be struck. And we have concluded that the reforms should be made to Scotland's system. This order deals with one aspect of this reform system, namely the responsibilities of individuals to self-disclose spent convictions and adjust the existing law governing those responsibilities. And these changes will be reflected and complemented by changes to the disclosure of spent conviction information by Disclosure Scotland. And these will be addressed by way of a remedial order using the urgent procedure provided for in the Convention Rights Compliance Scotland Act 2001. And this allows for a period of public consultation and parliamentary scrutiny after an order is made. Expediting the procedure in respect of this order ensures that the responsibilities of individuals and Disclosure Scotland to disclose spent conviction information will be aligned from the outset of the operation of the amended system. Presiding Officer, we believe that the changes proposed will put beyond doubt that the disclosure system in Scotland is compliant with the European Convention on Human Rights, while also ensuring that vulnerable people and the wider general public are protected. And while not all spent convictions will be routinely disclosed under this system, spent convictions for offences which are sufficiently serious, recent or relevant will continue to be required to be disclosed by the individual in the circumstances set out in the 2013 order. The amendments being proposed to the 2013 order set out two lists of offences. One list contains the most serious offences, including serious violent and sexual offences, which will continue to be disclosed indefinitely, even when spent, in relation to the types of work specified in the 2013 order. The second list contains offences in respect of which a new set of rules set out in the order will determine whether or not they are to be disclosed. And those rules take account of the period of time which has elapsed since conviction, the age of the offender on the date of conviction, and the sentence imposed. The order also adjusts rehabilitation legislation to take account of the amended system to be operated by Disclosure Scotland, in particular by ensuring that an individual need not disclose offences for which they may apply to a sheriff for an order to have them removed from a certificate until that application to the sheriff is determined. Presiding Officer, I want to reassure Parliament that members will have a further opportunity to scrutinise the underlying policy after the 60-day consultation on the remedial order. After it is made, we will consider whether any changes are required. If there are changes needed, these may also require to be reflected in the 2013 order. Any such changes would require to be made by a further affirmative order. Presiding Officer, I hope that this reassures you and members that Parliament will have a full and open role in the scrutiny process, albeit in an unusual format, with their views listened to throughout. But I also hope that members will agree that these amendments are necessary to ensure our system of higher level disclosures continues to operate to help protect vulnerable people and the public more generally, while also balancing the rights of individuals. Presiding Officer, I formally move the motion in my name.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Before I call Cara Hilton, can I say we have a little time in hand to get us to 5:30, so I'd appreciate your cooperation and help me to do so. Cara Hilton, a minimum of 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'll try to speak slow, but that could be difficult. Today's short debate on the Rehabilitation of Offenders Amendment Order is important, and it's important that we ensure that our disclosure system is fit for purpose and that we strike the right balance between protecting the public and enabling people with past convictions to make a personal and economic contribution to our society. As the Cabinet Secretary has outlined already, this is a debate that's been made necessary by a number of legal actions in England and Wales, and ultimately by the Supreme Court judgment, which concluded that our higher level disclosure system was in breach of Article 8 of the European Convention of Human Rights. So Scottish Labour appreciates that we must act speedily to ensure that Scotland isn't in breach of human rights legislation. It's pretty clear too that the system up till now hasn't been perfect and it's not always been proportionate. And we want to ensure that we've got a disclosure system which ensures both full and thorough scrutiny of people working with vulnerable groups and that protects our children and young people, but that doesn't automatically require everyone to disclose convictions that maybe occurred a long time ago, and doesn't take account of the age of the offender at the time. So this order really is about ensuring the right balance is struck, and we do accept the Scottish Government's case for change. But we are concerned, Presiding Officer, about the speed in which this order has been implemented. Tonight we're being asked to agree a draft order which was only laid on Monday the 7th of September. That's just 2 days ago. Yet this is in response to a UK Supreme Court decision made back in June 2014. In theory, there have been 15 months for this to be properly considered. I know this was an issue of debate at yesterday's Delegated Powers Committee. In this morning's papers, the Herald described the government's approach as scrambling to change the law within 2 days, with no real time for proper scrutiny or debate. And I don't think that reflects well on our Parliament. I don't think this is the best way to amend legislation which touches virtually everybody's lives.
John Mason.
I thank the member for giving way on that point. I think one of the reasons given at the committee yesterday was that because there's 1,000 disclosures a day, holding that up for 3 days meant that there were 3,000 disclosures not happening, or at least delayed. And I think the committee kind of accepted that that was probably acceptable.
Cara Hilton.
That's a fair point, which I think is I'm going to come to in a couple of pages' time. But I think for the public out there, people think, you know, the decision was made last June. Surely Parliament has had time to consider that by now. And, you know, I think it deserves a lot better scrutiny than 2 days. I think central to our focus in the disclosure system should be our responsibility. The primary responsibility should be ensuring that our system is robust and it offers the best possible protection for children, for young people and for vulnerable groups and to the organisations requiring disclosures. It shouldn't be about a rush to avoid legal challenge. Indeed, I would echo the report of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, who stated that the government's approach was most unusual and not one that the committee would see becoming common practice. I know that the Cabinet Secretary has acknowledged this today and that in our letters this week to the Justice Committee, to the Delegated Powers Committee and to the Education Committee, had recognised the widespread concern about this accelerated process, and that's welcome. I know that the Cabinet Secretary has said that Parliament will undertake what she's described as retrospective scrutiny, with the opportunity for a revised order to be laid to take account of any issues arising out of this retrospective scrutiny. But as the Delegated Powers Committee concluded in the report yesterday, should Parliament approve this order today, this will be the law, and further consideration by the committee will be undertaken in that context. But that aside, we are prepared to accept that the Scottish Government have had little option but to ensure the passage of this order as quickly as possible. Given that Disclosure Scotland, as John Mason has just pointed out, have already ceased issuing the high-level disclosures so that we can ensure public confidence in the system, if today's decision was to be delayed, then almost 1,000 certificates a day would not be able to be processed or issued. So speed is of the essence. Obviously, this would cause major hold-ups for people such as police officers, childcare workers, teachers, who are going through the process at the moment. And that's why Scottish Labour will be supporting the order at decision time today. I think our duty here has got to be to do all we can to keep our communities safe and the public protected. And that must be first and foremost when it comes to changes that affect children, young people and the most vulnerable groups. But we also need to ensure that the system is proportionate and doesn't undermine the rights of people who have had less serious convictions in the past and are looking to play a positive role in our society and our economy. Up until now, many of the disclosures people have made have been unnecessary. And an example given in the Supreme Court ruling was a woman refused a job in a care home 8 years after receiving a caution for shoplifting. We've all had constituents come to us telling us about a job opportunity that's been denied because maybe of a speeding conviction many years ago, or who have been involved in trouble as youngsters and decades on are still being made to pay the price. For too long, rules which are forced blanket disclosure or often irrelevant and sometimes unreliable information have blighted people's lives for too long. And we all know that disclosure of even the most minor criminal convictions can have a huge impact on individuals seeking employment. This especially impacts on men, who are 3 times more likely to have a criminal conviction than women. So having to disclose previous criminal activity can have an ongoing impact on people's ability to gain employment, to attend university or college, to volunteer, even to open a bank account. And all the evidence suggests that the key to ensuring people don't re-offend
is having those things, having a stable job, having access to education, positive family relationships, allowing people to move on and play a positive role, yet those are the opportunities that are being denied to some people by the way the system operates now. That said, I do think there will be some public concern about the list of offences which is included in the order of the type of offences that will now be disclosed. I think this list may be cast a wee bit too wide. For example, the list outlined in Schedule B1, which now might not be disclosed, includes public indecency and perjury. And I hope that in the 120-day period that Angela Constance has talked about, that there will be sufficient opportunity and time for retrospective scrutiny for any of these concerns to be fully taken on board. And I'm sure that the Scottish Government will fully engage with all the Parliament's committees, with all relevant stakeholders and with the public during this period. I would welcome assurances too from the Cabinet Secretary that Disclosure Scotland and its staff will be sufficiently and fully resourced and trained to adapt to the changes that we're agreeing today. Because ultimately these changes are about striking an important balance between public protection and people's right to have their privacy respected. And in conclusion, Presiding Officer, while I emphasise once more that we were a bit concerned about the way the order has been handled and about how this reflects on our Scottish Parliament, Scottish Labour will be supporting the Government's motion today.
Thank you, Ms Hilton. Can I now call Mary Scanlon?
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm very pleased to participate in this debate on the Amendment Order to the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act 1974, Exclusions and Exceptions, which was brought to our attention last week. I would like to thank the business managers, as Cara Hilton did, also the Cabinet Secretary and her officials, including the Minister for Parliament, I don't mean you're an official, but for your part in this, for keeping members informed of the circumstances surrounding the proposed changes to the system of higher level disclosures. There are two issues that need to be addressed, the first being the proposed reforms themselves, and the second being the accelerated process required to achieve their implementation. So, turning first to the reforms, let me be clear that robust scrutiny of individuals' backgrounds should be the prerequisite for anyone seeking employment in sensitive roles with vulnerable groups or positions of trust and responsibility. If the conviction is spent, but sufficiently serious and relevant to the remit of the role, our view is that it should always be disclosed. The gold standard must be to ensure the safety and security of those at risk, and rigorous tests therefore need to be in place. We simply cannot condone a soft touch approach on such an important issue. But equally, the current system, which requires self-disclosures of all convictions, regardless of how old and potentially minor they may be, is undoubtedly anachronistic and, in some cases, we accept could be unfairly prejudicial. As the Cabinet Secretary stated, in June 2014, the UK Supreme Court ruled to this effect. But it should be pointed out that the particular circumstances of the two cases that gave rise to this ruling could not have occurred in Scotland. Nevertheless, it is right that the system of disclosure is also under review north of the border. So, based on the evidence so far, the proposed changes do seem to be proportionate and acceptable. But looking at Schedule B1, I quote, offences which are to be disclosed subject to rules. Cara Hilton touched on this issue. We do have some concerns that individuals with previous convictions for offences such as fire raising, fraud, housebreaking, theft and public indecency could potentially end up working in sensitive roles and with vulnerable groups. So while I appreciate that the non-disclosure of these offences will be dependent on a number of variables, such as the disposal given and the passage of time since conviction, I do very much hope that in practice it is exercised judiciously and sensibly. It's also important that the public fully understands the forthcoming changes to the higher level disclosure system and the implications that these will have on future employment where applicable. These reforms are fairly technical in nature, and the effect of such changes will need to be communicated in a clear transparent and accessible way. So, turning briefly to the accelerated procedure necessitated by the affirmative order, I understand that Disclosure Scotland has ceased issuing higher level disclosures to ensure public confidence in the disclosure system. This is obviously a cause for concern given the sheer volume of disclosure certificates that will not be processed as the instruments are being scrutinised. We understand around 1,000 each day. We do, presiding officer, support the action taken today by the government. We support the measures that have been outlined by the Cabinet Secretary in this debate, but we do ask the government to continue to monitor this situation closely to make sure it has no adverse effects, and we would like to ensure that this Parliament, or to ask that this Parliament, is kept fully informed of any potential future changes and implementation. And thank you.
Thank you, Ms Scanlon. Can I now call Nigel Dawn to speak on behalf of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee? I would be obliged, Mr Dawn, if you would continue until 5:25.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I should be happy to try to do so. I am grateful for the opportunity to be able to speak on behalf of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee about this extremely important statutory instrument, which of course only was published on Monday afternoon and therefore came to my committee yesterday morning with relatively little opportunity to scrutinise it. It does, as others have commented, change the rules on the responsibilities individuals have to self-disclose, and also adjust the rules on what information about an individual's previous criminal activity can actually be used against that individual in various proceedings. I would like to thank not only the government for keeping us informed on the possibility that this might arrive, but also my clerks, or my committee's clerks, and our legal advisers, who must have burned some candle wax in providing the advice to us. I'd also like to thank members of the committee for their robust scrutiny of it in an hour and 40 minutes yesterday morning. Note also that the official report turned their work round very quickly, so that not only was our report but also the official report were published yesterday afternoon, giving all members an opportunity to see what had happened. The exceptional circumstances and timing of this have already been noted. Clearly we was not, as a committee, expect this to happen very frequently, but I'm sure it won't. Now, in the limited time available to my committee, I think it just simply has to be said that we have not been able to draw quite as many conclusions as we might have done on all the other instruments that come before us. But we have been able to draw the conclusion that there is no reason why we should report this. If I may quote from the committee's report, in the time available to consider the draft order, the committee has not formed the view that the instrument raises a devolution issue. Nor, however, can the committee be confident that no such issues arise. The committee considers that some of the policy choices which have been made in the draft order require further investigation with regard to the tests laid down by the UK Supreme Court in T and another case. Further, in the evidence gathered to date, members recognise that within the range of potentially convention-compatible solutions, distinct policy choices have been made, and the relevant lead committees will wish to explore those.
Member, give way.
Indeed.
John Mason.
I thank the member for giving way. I appreciate what he says, and I very much agree with the conclusion the committee came to, of which I'm a vice convener. The one point that the court had raised was the question that no assessment was undertaken of the relevance of the information disclosed to the purpose for which the disclosure was required. I mean, would you accept that there's a bit of uncertainty around that? Because although there's the right of appeal, in a sense, there's not, Disclosure Scotland themselves are not looking at the purpose.
Nigel Dawn.
The member rightfully and helpfully brings out the one point which I think was a slight concern to us. Before I put that in context, though, or rather to put that in context, can I be clear that what the Cabinet Secretary laid out before us was a set of rules? And I think we recognise that it needs to be a set of rules. It cannot be a circumstance where anybody in Disclosure Scotland is required to provide their own discretionary view on the applicability of the rules, because otherwise that's no longer Disclosure Scotland, that is some kind of tribunal, which Disclosure Scotland isn't. So the rules as laid down quite clearly pick out the different categories of offence, and they quite clearly pick out the time that has elapsed since the offence took place and the age of the offender at the time of conviction. But as John Mason has pointed out, it's not clear that they, well, it's clear that they don't specifically cover the relevance or otherwise of a particular offence conviction to the job which, for which the individual is applying. And that is something which I think all parties will have to consider. But I don't think, and this is need to be clear, Presiding Officer, that is not a reason for reporting these. We are entirely comfortable as a committee that this does satisfy the primary test. We cannot see why it should be reported. We believe that fundamentally it is capable of satisfying Article 8 of the European Convention on Human Rights, and accordingly, and we've reported accordingly. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Dorn. Can I now call on Angela Constance to wind up the debate? Cabinet Secretary, to 5:29, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I start by welcoming the very constructive contributions from members from Cara Hilton, from Mary Scanlon, Nigel Dawn, and of course the two interventions that we've had this evening from John Mason. I do once again want to thank Parliament for agreeing to this accelerated process, and pay tribute to members for their understanding of the position of where we start from, and it's that the UK Supreme Court decision and the subsequent case law that has caused us to consider the operation of higher level disclosures. And I appreciate the acceptance that people have supported the government's view in that our conclusions are that change is necessary, and people appear to be accepting of that. We are of the view that changes should be made to ensure that the disclosure of spent convictions is more proportionate. And the reforms seek the right balance between, firstly and foremost, public protection and, of course, the rights of individuals. And these reforms will continue to ensure that vulnerable groups are protected with a person's background assessed for any relevant conviction. And it is important to stress, Presiding Officer, that with the most serious of spent convictions, that they will always be disclosed. And of course, due to the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act, there are some convictions that will never, ever be spent, and particularly for those convictions that warrant a custodial sentence of 30 months or more, those offences will never be spent. So these reforms allow those with minor criminal convictions to put their past offending behaviour behind them, enabling them to become more productive members of society and not to be penalised for very old and minor convictions. Presiding Officer, I acknowledge to Chamber that we have taken the time to fully understand the direct relevance of each element of the UK Supreme Court judgment and the emerging case law, and how that applies in a Scottish context. Because Mary Scanlon is right, the original case that went to the UK Supreme Court was in a relation to a case in England that could not actually happen in Scotland. So we had to look at matters very carefully and very closely in relation to standard and enhanced disclosures, and also the PVG scheme. And then to develop the, in a moment, and then to develop the complex policy and operational solutions needed to implement an amended disclosure regime for higher level disclosures. I'm happy to give way to Mr. Simpson.
The Minister would actually perhaps write to me about the exclusion relating to proceedings before the Mental Health Tribunal or the Mental Wealth Commission for Scotland, because I really find that bit very difficult to understand why that was still disapplied.
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, absolutely, and I give that undertaking to Mr Simpson, Presiding Officer. We had begun to focus yesterday at committee on some of the other aspects of this in terms of firearms legislation, gambling legislation, and the point that Mr Simpson raises, that we do need to address any concerns he has in relation to mental health law and the mental health tribunal system for Scotland, and I will give a personal undertaking to doing that in the fullest possible terms. Presiding Officer, it is important to acknowledge that irrespective of the length of time prior to coming to Parliament, that we would have always have sought an expedited process, and essentially that this unusual parliamentary process was used to ensure as little disruption to the issuing of higher level disclosures as possible. And we've heard from members that for every day that Disclosure Scotland does not operate, that means 1,000 higher level disclosure applications cannot be processed, and we have sought to minimise that disruption to 3 days, because we all understand that disruption is undesirable, and it has an impact on an applicant's ability to secure jobs and also an impact on an employer's ability to fill vacant posts. Nonetheless, I can reassure Chamber that Disclosure Scotland is fully resourced and ready to deal with that 3-day backlog as quickly as possible, and they are confident that they will still meet their targets in relation to completing 90% of applications within 14 days. Presiding Officer, my final point is that in terms of continued scrutiny, this Government will welcome continued scrutiny on all of these matters. There is 120 days, 60 days for written views to be submitted, another 60 days in terms of committee reports. There will have to be a further parliamentary statement. But more fundamentally, we do want to ensure that we have the right offences on the right list, and we will work very closely with Parliament to ensure that the detail of the affirmative order is absolutely right. Presiding Officer, tomorrow the remedial order will be placed, and it will come into force on the same day as the affirmative order. And this allows for the correction of any potential incompatibilities as well as any actual incompatibilities with ECHR. And we believe that the changes that we are proposing to Parliament tonight will underpin a disclosure regime in Scotland that is compatible and compliant with ECHR and will continue to protect the public. And I'm grateful to Parliament, and I seek Parliament's support for this order, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the very short debate on the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act 1974, Exclusions and Exceptions Scotland Amendment Order 2015. The next item of business is consideration of business motion number 14191 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a revision to the business programme on Thursday 10th September. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request to speak button now. And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 14191.
Moved.
No member has asked to speak against the motion, therefore I now put the question to the Chamber. The question is that motion number 14191 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. The next item of business is consideration of business motion number 14175 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a business programme. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request to speak button now. And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 14175.
Moved.
No member is asked to speak against the motion, therefore I now put the question to the Chamber. The question is that motion number 14175 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. The next item of business is consideration of a Parliamentary Bureau motion. I would ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 14173 on approval of an SSI.
Moved.
The question on this motion will be put at decision time. Before we come to decision time, I'd like to say a few words to mark a special occasion. As we commemorate the milestone of our longest-serving monarch, I had the pleasure and privilege to be with Her Majesty the Queen today. I was therefore in the very fortunate position to be able to pass on in person the best wishes and warmest congratulations on behalf of the Scottish Parliament. During the event today, the wonderful opening of the Borders Railway, I saw yet again the commitment of a woman who has worked through decades of public service. That incredible commitment has not diminished with the passing of time. I'm sure all MSPs will wish to join me today in marking not just a landmark moment in terms of her history, but in the remarkable and dedicated journey of one woman's life of public service. Thank you. There are five questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is Amendment number 14167.2 in the name of Margaret Burgess, which seeks to amend motion number 14167 in the name of Ken Macintosh on housing and wellbeing in Scotland be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed. We move to a vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on Amendment number 14167.2 in the name of Margaret Burgess is as follows. Yes, 63. No, 54. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore agreed to. The next question is Amendment number 14167.1 in the name of Alex Johnson, which seeks to amend motion number 14167 in the name of Ken Macintosh and on housing and wellbeing in Scotland be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament is not agreed. We move to vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on Amendment number 14167.1 in the name of Alex Johnson is as follows. Yes, 14. No, 103. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. The next question is that motion number 14167 in the name of Ken Macintosh as amended on housing and wellbeing in Scotland be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament's not agreed. We move to a vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on motion number 14167 in the name of Ken Macintosh as amended is as follows. Yes, 95. No, 18. There were four abstentions. The motion as amended is therefore agreed to. The next question is that motion number 14189 in the name of Angela Constance on the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act 1974 Exclusions and Exceptions Scotland Amendment Order 2015 draft be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. The next question is that motion number 14173 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on approval of an SSI be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. That concludes decision time. We now move to members' business. Members who leave in the chamber should do so quickly and quietly.